Well, if you're seeing this video, it's a minor miracle. I had a cyber attack, basically, on my computer. Going into a, trying to download a Tibetan, an English Tibetan font that is English. It looks like Tibet that the Chinese have developed, and the website was a virus actually, and I've had tremendous problems getting anything to open, record, upload, nothing, but just praying to the grace of God, Dharma King Longchenpa, to free us from this pestilence. So at least I can see that I'm recording here. Whether or not it will continue to record is the question, right? But we will do the best that we can here. This is a danger. Opening any website is a danger, actually. I mean, just stick with the ones you know are safe. It's just amazing how treacherous the internet is. It's just horrible. I just stick with YouTube, and if I need to Google something, I will. Then if I need to look something up, Wikipedia. That's pretty much it. Maybe the email, maybe Facebook. But you're just asking for absolute trouble. Amazing, huh? What a wonderful place this is. But this all ties in very wonderfully with what we're doing. Great synchronicity here. Cyber attack by the Chinese, by the way, is most likely going to take place soon. Warfare in the future, as the Chinese have said, is going to be cyber warfare, economic cyber warfare. And they have been training for that. Millions have been training to carry out some massive cyber attack. So this is what we have to look forward to in the future, along with, actually, there's another layer to it. I wouldn't blame the Chinese entirely. They're being used. They're being used by the New World Order cabal, who is actually the ones carrying out the cyber attack, intended to create chaos in the world, and then they come in as the saviors of, we can reorder the whole thing. So we're headed towards very weird times. Everybody knows that. Okay, fine. What is our job? Protect our minds from this, or protect our mental state, as it were, from all of this. Is this possible? Absolutely it's possible. In fact, we're going to do it. In fact, it's already done. It's already done. It's a done deal. Just breathe that in. It's a done deal. See, this is how we work. It's already done. As Buddha said, the fortunate ones, they're already on the other side. The ones that really know the truth, they're already on the other side. It's not about crossing. How do we cross the river? No, it's recognizing they're already across. Why? Well, ultimately, there isn't any river to cross. But our goal is to recognize the ability to abide in mind. Recognize the ability. And practice and recognize that ability. That's just, healed perception is as far as we need to go, but healed perception is enough. It is absolutely sufficient. So, to get us rolling here, this is very intense. We're trying to go as fast as possible before the weirdness begins. And the weirdness is going to begin quite soon, perhaps by the end of May or the beginning of June, and certainly by July 24th of 2016. There may be preliminary stuff going on prior to July 24th. This is what I understand. But like I said, it's already done. We've already succeeded. We've already succeeded. That's it. So get into this mindset. We've already succeeded. And all we're doing is kind of going back over how we succeeded and just sort of recognizing, oh yeah, okay, yes. But we've already succeeded. Feel that. See how different that feels? When you say this and take this perspective, there's a whole different feeling to it. The fear sort of starts evaporating, doesn't it? I've already succeeded. Now, you might understand why Longchenpa is certainly Johnny on the spot. Probably he wasn't all too thrilled about what took place in Tibet starting in 1959 and the attempt to eradicate the Dharma in Tibet. Probably wasn't too thrilled about that. And so he's probably like saying, got his attention, you might say. And so he's probably not too thrilled about the attempt to eradicate the Dharma in this world either, right? I mean, someone who is the Dharma, you know, who is Vajrasattva, is not going to, you know, be cheerleading for the eradication of the Dharma, of the truth in this world, and for the momentum. He's going to be saying, well, not so fast. No, I don't think so. And we're going to find a way around that, sidestep that issue. So, yeah, I'd say he's very motivated. That's why his grace is fast, profound and fast. You believe it or not, there's some of us that actually care about this. And he seems to care, you know, 100%. Beyond belief, unbelievability, and unbelievability, an ability beyond belief. So we have these wonderful allies here helping us out. And when they're here, it's a done deal. It's a done deal. So I asked, the computer wasn't working. I asked him to get the computer to work, and lo and behold, it's working now. I couldn't do anything. I kept restarting. Nothing would work. Nothing would open. I asked him for just to, you know, through your grace, let the computer work, and boom, it's working. So we have to believe in, we have to accept the unbelievability, okay, of the mind. Of mind. Mind beyond belief. Now, so those of you who are really grinding and practicing, and you know, keep at it, because I'm right with you too, doing the same here. And so let us look into the nuts and the bolts, get under the hood, and really, you know, dig into it of what are we doing here? What we need to do is just abide in this unbelievability. Accept it. Pristine, I am pristine unbelievability. And just practice in abiding in that. And this protects us, actually, from any imagined instability or whatever. Because all that instability is only happening in belief. But I am the pristine unbelievability. The ability to go beyond belief, you see. The ability to set belief down, to accept the unbelievable, which is perfection. Belief is denying perfection. So the ultimate belief is to believe in unbelievability. Okay, so my final belief is to believe in pristine, that I am pristine unbelievability, and abide in that. Now, I had this dream where I was running this marathon. Somehow I got suckered into it. I don't know if it was suckered or not. Maybe it's a spiritual path. And I came upon this, something we had to do on this marathon trip path. And we had to go up this sort of staircase. It was sort of like a very precarious seeming, like going up some scaffolding almost. But we were climbing up. This was part of the route we had to take, and I got to some level of these stairs, and the stairs were like just out in space. Okay? It was just the stairs and some handrails, but there was nothing else. They were just going up, and you're looking around. And you say, "Wow, this is very precarious. I don't know." And you reach a certain point where it was like it seemed to be like foggy, where you couldn't even see the stairs. And this was the test. Can you go forward at that point? And so I had the handrails. I said, okay, feel the handrails. So I said, okay, let me just take another step. There's the stairs. So I could you couldn't see the stairs anymore because of the fog. Wow. So this was a really extreme test. And I managed to, on faith and determination, I said, I know the stairs are there. And so I was able to climb up through this trial and get to the top. When I got to the top, there was a landing area up at the top of the stairs, really high up there. I don't know how high, but it was very, very high. And there was light up there. You could see the landing area, and there was some assistance up there. And they said, all right, you made it, that's great. And they said, here, you get a bracelet. They put a bracelet tag sort of on my, like in hospitals, they put this, you know, plastic tag. They put some zip tag on my wrist saying, you know, that you've made it, you did this. You managed to do it. It was you know, you passed the test. And then there were like stairs going down, but these stairs going down were much more stable. And I was like, okay, so I'm up there, and then suddenly I hear this commotion. I say, what? And someone starts sobbing and crying and weeping and like hysterical. I say, what's going on? And I look, and there's this lady all dressed in red, entirely red. Red skin, red shoes, red dress, red belt, red hair, red everything. It's like she was crying, and you know, like she was just freaked out, completely freaked out. She couldn't stand it up there. She just couldn't stand it. I was like, wow, what is this? And she wouldn't calm down. And then I realized that now it's time for me to walk down these stairs, down to the earth again. So I said, obviously she wanted to get out of there and go back down, but she couldn't. She was too unnerved by everything. So I said, well, I'm going down. I'll take her hand and I'll help her down the steps. And they said, okay. And she took my hand and I helped her walk down all the steps. And we got down close to the earth again, the ground. And at that point, she didn't need my hand anymore. That she had stabilized. And then she took off on her own direction. And I don't know where she went. And this morning I'm looking at this dream. It's a very powerful dream. And it ties in with exactly the progress that I've been making here. And to try to explain it, this lady in red appeared there as a complex, marketing complex that I've been carrying around of collectivism, collective effort. The idea that collectively we can make the impossible happen. This is the height of Erickson's delusion. And of course, this lady in red ties into the whole idea of collectivism, which is what communism, which is exemplified by the red Chinese, is together, collectively, we can accomplish what by ourselves we can't. And what are we trying to accomplish? Changing reality. Okay. So By taking this faith of going up these stairs and doing it, this complex came out of me. It couldn't handle it. It couldn't handle this anymore. It couldn't handle the clarity and the wisdom there. And so it had sort of like separated from me, or it came out from me. In other words, it was no longer bound to me. And then I was able to see what this complex is all about. It feels profoundly uncomfortable with truth and wisdom, arrogance, of the arrogance of collectivism, which is what the world's New World Order is all about, actually, which is why they tried to destroy Tibet, because Tibet has this high wisdom. It's a repository for truth, and they feel extremely uncomfortable with it and try to eradicate it, actually. And now have glossed it all over with their, you know, fakery, you know, marketing campaign. Look how happy the plateau region of China is now with these nice monasteries here. We have these, and you know, this is what they do. Yeah, they make fakes, junk, but make it look like it's real, and they delight in their cleverness at doing this. You know, the arrogance is arrogance. So let's not be fooled by this. This is the truth. This is the truth. This is the fact. And so this, I experienced it. This lady in red was extremely uncomfortable. The mother believing in matter was extraordinarily uncomfortable. She was hysterical. She couldn't think. She couldn't pull herself. She wanted to go back down to the earth, you know, to matter, you know, to mother, to mater, to form, to making things, to materialism. And collectively, we can make enough to be happy. Collectively, we can achieve our goals. This notion. Well, guess what? Achieving the impossible is impossible. It's not a goal. It's an impossibility. So this whole notion of collectivism is utter nonsense. Total, nothing but arrogance. There's nothing that needs to be achieved in reality. Reality is not collectivism in terms of trying to reach a goal, working together to reach a goal. It's pristine in oneness. Inherently, we all experience what everyone else is experiencing. But we're not working together to reach some goal at all. We're completely free. Everyone is completely free. And at the same time, we are all experiencing the experiencing of everyone else's freedom. This is reality. So the collectivism that this world is believing in is again, the arrogant dream of trying to script reality and then claim that they can make a better script and then claim that they're greater than God. It's not a goal, it's an impossibility. So this mindset cannot handle the truth at all. And this is what I experienced. So, every time we make a practice like this, our perspective on the mind is going to be irretrievably changed for the better. Keep this in mind. Every time we practice, we realize we'll never be the same again. We'll never be the same again. And this is how we go into the practice. We'll never be the same again. Because we're going to get a clearer perspective on the mind. We're going to see our unbelievability. We're going to become familiar with our unbelievability. In other words, ability beyond belief, right? We have ability that is greater than belief. Belief is we used it to try and, you know, change reality. We could only believe in it. We couldn't actually do it. You see, but believing in the impossible doesn't make it possible. Doesn't matter how collectively we all believe in arrogance. It doesn't make it true. Arrogance means just to arrogate whatever we want. We say, okay, this is the way reality is, as if we are the prime creator. So we just arrogate qualities that we don't have, or think we just claim, oh, this is, yeah, that's possible, or you've done this. Well, we haven't. It's not possible. That's just arrogance. So arrogance is a very, it's like quicksand. It's terrible. So we get a fundamental change in our perspective on the mind as we practice here. And we'll never be going back to that nonsense. But every time we practice, there's part of this marketing campaign of arrogance that we have bought into to a certain extent, based on maybe intrigued by it or pressured or foolish, whatever, that this seems to like separate out from us, that it's no longer glued, you know, becoming unglued. And so this marketing campaign, it seems to then depart from us. It's no longer part of us. Of course, we're not parts. It's just this marketing campaign has all these parts to it. And we say, oh, okay, that's no longer part of what I believe in. As I go towards my unbelievability, I don't need all this belief. And so it starts to leave you. It starts to leave you. This is what I experienced in the dream. But I brought it back down to earth and let it go, and it disappeared. And so when we practice, we're practicing not taking these beliefs with us into practice, because they'll freak out. So the key to abidance is just don't take this belief in collectivism into your practicing of abidance. Just don't take it there. Don't take that lady in red there. It's a powerful symbol. A very powerful symbol of delusion, lady in red. the warrior goddess, it's the feminine that spreads the flesh. It spreads this collectivism of the flesh throughout the globe. They're the ones, you know, that's pushing it. That's why in battle they have the warrior goddess is the chosen icon for conquering, for conquering. They put them on the ships, the bows of ships that are going to conquer other lands. That here comes, you know, here comes the woman, our flesh, our mother, our flesh, into this land, and we're going to populate this land with our flesh. Okay, this is what it is about. So the idea is of this collectivism that we're going to, you know, populate the world with this collectivist ideal, that together we can accomplish what? The impossible. Together we can script reality. Together we can bind freedom. And yet actually this is only aimless wandering around. Aimless arrogance, actually. All arrogance is aimless arrogance. This is what we see. All arrogance is aimless arrogance. So there may be some reactions. I just had a reaction there. As you say this, like, oh, so like the marketing campaign that you still is adhering to me is like, you can't say that. I thought it, but saying it, I can feel this reaction there. It interferes with breathing, your breath, and speaking. All arrogance is aimless arrogance. There's no such thing as purposeful arrogance. It's all aimless. The impossible can never be an aim. So trying to accomplish the impossible is only aimlessness. No matter how arrogant we seem, it's only aimlessness. Wandering about aimlessly is all we're doing. As we entertain arrogance, the belief that we can be greater than God, the belief that we can be separate, other than, different. What is God? The allness, the allness, omnipresence of allness. Allness, all is all. All is all. Always. All is all, always. All is all, always. Triple A, all is all, always. Just remember that. Reality was God, triple A. All is all, always. That means nothing is fixated, ever. That doesn't mean we can't experience something for as long as we want. It's just that it's not fixated. Meaning we're not bound to it. Our freedom is not fixated by it. We can't say, oh, we've been experiencing this for so long, therefore we can't experience something else. Or this has to be part of what we experience. This has to be a precursor, or it has to influence what we experience in the future. None of that happens in reality at all. All is all, always. Or all is always all. All is always all. All is always all. All is all, always. So we have to now, you know, really focus in. It is to work on not bringing these complexes into practice avoidance in the first place, because they'll panic. This is what I found out going up these stairs. This dream is, I still had this complex there, but it wasn't glued very tightly, so I was able to get to the top of the stairs. If I tightly adhered to collectivism, I never could have gone up those stairs, you see. So I'd already loosened it up so much I was able to go up those stairs. And then at that part, it became completely unglued from me. And then I saw the complex, this red female completely in red. And I saw that she simply was freaking out as if she was in a void. I lost her identity, could see no identity there. Well, of course, belief only sees identity in belief. And belief is always, well, the purpose we get of belief is to believe that reality isn't real. Okay? Now, we can give a different purpose to belief and believe reality is real, which by saying that I am that pristine unbelievability. Okay? I have the ability to set belief down and accept something which belief cannot believe in, which is perfection. It can't experience it. We can't experience it through belief. It's not possible. But I have the ability to see this, to see that the limits of belief. Okay? Say that. I have the ability to see the limits of belief and realize that belief, I have the ability to set belief down and experience what is, you know, perfect, experience perfection, always. So we do have that final usage of belief, that I believe that what I am is the pristine unbelievability. Jesus calls it the illusion that removes all other illusions, and having done so then is able to set itself down easily as well. So as we practice, whatever it is that's becoming unglued from us, belief, we will later, that's the wow, the backlash, wow, this has come unglued from me, and it's no longer, I realize this is not really part of me at all. It's not needed. I don't need this anymore. Let's put it that way. I don't need this belief anymore. And so it departs from you. And then it's like, wow, I don't have that anymore. So you realize I'm now going to have a different perspective, right? Absolutely. And so this is, I say, the shifting of the landscape that happens within us when we're practicing. Every time we make a practice, some belief we realize this belief is not necessary anymore. I don't need to have that belief anymore. And it becomes unglued from us and leaves us. Landscape shifts, landscape changes, and then it's like, wow, just imagine if suddenly our whole yard, whole landscape where we are, it all changes, it's all different. It's like whoa. And for a while you just want to sit there and just kind of look, okay, the tree, no more tree there, something else there's different, there, bushes are different, this is different, this is the walkway's different, everything's different, but it's the similarities too. So you get used to the similarities, but you just kind of take it. Don't immediately go out there. Just sit there. Just sit there quietly. Don't do anything. This is called full stop in the wow. Don't think. Don't evaluate. Just get used to it. I say, I'm still okay. I'm just sitting here. So the landscape of my belief has just shifted. Okay, that's fine. I am that pristine unbelievability, actually. Wow. I just got a sudden, in my being there. Wow. Sudden feeling of shift there. So, wow. Lightheadedness, sudden feeling of lightheadedness there. A little, or not quite lightheadedness, but kind of like that, though. Or sudden feeling of sort of instability, kind of like when you're like on a high bridge or some high place, and you kind of go, whoa, like this, and you feel something like your equilibrium sudden, you know, feels like a feeling of like altered equilibrium or something. It's like, whoa, like that. I just felt that. I'm feeling very strongly right now. Wow. So then, wow, like in the dream, I got to this place where I realized that the steps really couldn't be seen now anymore. Very, like they're beyond belief, I'd say, beyond perception. And I felt, you know, this trepidation and instability for a little while. But then I kind of stabilized myself and said, no, I can keep going. I'm going to keep going. But it took a lot of determination. So in saying all this, I'm feeling this instability by sharing this. It's not easy to share. It's a lot easier just to look at it internally, but to express it like this, this is difficult. Now I realize that there's been some great progress I've been made here. How can I tell? Well, my golf swing always shows up, my mental state. It shows. Absolutely it does, because it's this coordinated movement that has to be, you have to let it go. You know, at some point you got to swing it. and if it's not right, it's not right. You got to let go and see what happens. So it's very indicative, very, very indicative of where you're at. And my golf swing right now is, I could just get up, come out, and right out of the box, start swinging great, right from the start. It's fundamentally different than before. Before, it takes so many swings and warming up, and gradually I dial something in. But it would be, you know, bad and awkward and wouldn't be right. Now, it's dialed in from the very beginning. And it's like, wow. Every time I do it, I'm like, wow, this is so different than before. So I could just stumble out on the first tee and the swing is there. Chodron said to me, he was on the second tee of the golf course. He says, what are you practicing for? That's stupid. You don't need to practice. Laughing. The Dakini that showed up there. Chandra Tsering Chodron, the spiritual consort of Chamyang Yensi Choki Lodro. Great master, Tibetan master of Dzogchen. Maybe even a Dharma king himself, you know? Possible. It's possible that we may have even had a Dharma king in this world just, you know, recently. If he wasn't, he was just very close to it. I'm telling you that. So he may have very well been. So she is showed up, appeared, and laughed hysterically as I was taking practice swings on a golf course there, and just like completely unglued me. I just was like unglued, but I said, wow, what is this? And ultimately I suddenly realized that I don't need to practice. Practice is redundant. There's no need to practice. Just get up and hit it. So what she said is, you need to get it right out of the bat. I mean, this is the realization to have this unbelievability. So you don't need to practice. You see, we're going beyond practice. Belief is always practicing. You're saying abidance. And as soon as we think we need to practice, we're out of abidance. Abidance is unbelievability. We're just accepting this ability we have. It's beyond belief. So there's no need to practice it. So now I have this swing, and I just know what I'm doing, and it comes off really well just from the get-go. It's very different. Never had this before. I have experienced miracles from Jamyang Kensi Choki Lodro. Absolutely. He has that capability to call upon him, and his grace will respond. So again, he may very well be a Dharma king. should we make him our fifth Dharma king? I don't know. But we really need to have these Dharma kings that we call upon and for miracles, and that we get the miracles, okay? Now, ultimately, it's all the Holy Spirit, of course. But sometimes I find that I can focus better if I feel I'm calling upon someone that's been in this world, right? Understands. That's why people call upon Jesus. He was here. He understands the troubles we have here. These teachers, all of them, we have, they were here in the world. They understand the temptations, the pressure, the arrogance, and all of this stuff. And they know how to. So the Holy Spirit, of course, is never born into a world, into any form or world or anything like that. So this is entirely abstract. So it's helpful, it can be, to call upon one of these Dharma kings, or all of them, to help us out. And we just feel kind of like that they understand, you know, they understand why we're pleading for their help, which is kind of helpful for us to, you know, because sometimes we feel like, does the Holy Spirit really understand our problems? You know, we kind of feel silly, like, you know, like, doesn't see any problems. Now, of course it does, but it understands it all perfectly, which is hard for us to grasp. But anyway, all grace comes from the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit has these emanations that have been in the world, and we can relate to them and feel like they understand why we're calling upon them. Let's put, they really, we know that they get it. We know Longchenpa understands. He was persecuted and not listened to, and, you know, all through, ignored and disbelieved, and, you know, all the ups and downs and all this stuff. And Jesus, they all know what it's all about here, and they know our frailties and our habits, bad habits, and our continuity fear. And so when we call upon them, we have confidence that they certainly can appreciate our trepidation and our efforts. As feeble as they may seem, they certainly appreciate them. Let me see if I can put it in a different way. They certainly recognize why we're calling upon them to bolster our efforts, to bolster our efforts. I'm trying to put it in a certain way here. It'll come. We certainly know that they share our goals and can relate to perhaps our efforts not being all that we would like them to be. Let's put it that way. We would like our effectiveness to be greater. And they themselves experience this lack of effectiveness. And Sri Sri Anandamayi Mao said, you know, my whole life being here, meeting millions and millions of people, and very, very few. So there were a few, but not many came to me actually for the truth. Okay, most of them came to just wanted to have belief seem more palatable to them. Tried to make their arrogance more palatable. Their aimlessness, they wanted to have some, their aimlessness seemed to have some meaning to them. That's what they came for. They didn't really come for liberation, for waking up, you know. They didn't come for that. They came for miracles, but physical miracles, like make my aimlessness less aimless for me. But I want to keep the arrogance, but make it less aimless. Well, you know, what can you do? So Jesus certainly experienced all the persecutions, right? Ramana was certainly persecuted early on by many, and many did not understand, you know, what he's about. Why don't you talk? Why don't you talk? Why don't you know? So they all, we can relate to us feeling like, you know, I can do more. I want to do more. I want I want to be free of suffering. I want to be free of suffering. Or, maybe more to the point, we are so scared of dropping all time instantly, which of course the Holy Spirit could do for us like that, that we might be afraid the Holy Spirit will give us too much, too quickly. And so that by praying to these Dharma kings, we feel that they might understand our desire to have a little bit of time lag, you know, and not give us too much. That's probably what it really is, right? It's protection from too much, too fast. So the Holy Spirit understands that. It's not offended by it at all. We don't want too much, too fast. And knowing that these Dharma kings are here in the world, and they seem to not overdo it here, we feel that they are safe in that way. And on Sri Anandamayi, she could do any miracle at all, but she didn't. It was only if someone really asked for it and was called for it. Otherwise, she wouldn't do any at all. So it's not like saying, hey, let me do a miracle for you. No. If it was called for, it would happen. That's all. If it wasn't called for, it wouldn't happen. Same with Jesus. Same with all of these. A lady comes and asks Ramana for a miracle. Her son's dying. He says, I can't help you. He's bitten by a snake. He says, well, you know, what am I? I'm not a doctor or something. And so she wouldn't help him, apparently. They always come asking for miracles. That's what they want, right? Oh, you know, my arrogance is causing me problems. Can you lessen the problems my arrogance is causing me? But let me keep my arrogance. That's what they always ask for. So the lady left, and she's so upset. He didn't listen to me. He didn't do anything for him. Oh, terrible. And then she goes outside the ashram, is walking home, and there's someone who's just like an expert in treating snake bites. And so he treats her son and he gets well. And they ask Ramana, you did a miracle. He says, no, whatever is bound to happen will happen, and what is not bound to happen won't happen. So we could be absolutely divested of this nonsense of a world instantly. Ask the Holy Spirit, and it's done, if we want to, absolutely. So we're probably a little afraid of the just absolute effectiveness of the Holy Spirit. The instantaneous effectiveness, totally. It's already succeeded, in completely succeeded. The Holy Spirit has already saved everyone, actually. It's already happened. It happened in an instant, Jesus says. Just one instant, and it was all done. The Holy Spirit did it just in an instant. But we're still honoring time, which I call our continuity fear, really. We have this continuity fear, so we still hold on to time. So we're just taking a while to accept this fact that it's already accomplished. This whole arrogance only lasted for just a moment like that. We had the idea concurrently. The God gave us the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit resolved the entire thing in the instant. And that's it. And yet, we can reminisce about our honoring of time. And it seems to drag out billions of years and like that. Yeah, absolutely we can. That's what we're doing. So it may be that we ask these teachers, and we're just saying, you know, they probably won't give me too much. They might have some limitations. This helps us. This helps us. We trust them. You know, they're not going to give us too much. Yeah, they'll give me a diamond, but don't give me a pile of diamonds. You know, that might like, too much. They could give us a pile of diamonds. But they showed in their lives they didn't just indiscriminately try to impress everybody with miracles. If something needed to happen, it would happen. And they're not the only ones. I mean, Christianity is full of saints that did all sorts of miracles. I mean, Jesus said, all these miracles I've done, you will do those and more. There have been Christian saints who've multiplied food, absolutely. And Anandamayi did too. Hindu saints, absolutely. Tibetan saints, sure. Or Buddhist saints, you know. If they need them, like Saint Peregrino, patron saint, I believe that's in. Patron saint of cancer, AIDS, cancer, those kind of things. He did all sorts of miracles. He multiplied food. That's what they say. And again, Sri Sri Anandamayi multiplied food many times. Food never ran out. Didn't matter how many people came. They said, why, we started out with so little. What's going on here? It's just if it needs to be, if there needs to be food, there's food. That's all. It's just light. It's just ornamentation. It's light ornamenting its own spaciousness. You know, it's spacious ornamenting its own spaciousness. That's all. So we call upon miracles, and we call upon little miracles. You know, make my computer work. Okay. Yeah. We're kind of afraid of a lot of miracles, so we kind of plead, hey, Longchenpa, don't too much, you know, please just, you know, that's really what we're pleading. If we probably hurt ourselves, we'd be pleading, you know, don't do too much, slow, not so fast, not so fast, not so fast. I don't want to, you know, turn into a light body, which we certainly could at some point, but we're not going to do that. Let's get into this. Not right now. We're going to abide, recognize our unbelievability. Absolutely. We're going to recognize it. We're going to see it and abide in the seeing of it. Okay. We're not going to utilize it to the ultimate extent right at this point. Okay. Let's make this very clear. Our goal is to simply abide in the recognition of our unbelievability. Abide in the recognition of that. And Jesus says that's enough. Now, could we do a Padmasambhava and it just turned into a light body? Of course, yeah, at some point when we might, but not right now. We're not trying to scare people, okay? We're not trying to overwhelm people. We're not trying to show off or anything like that. If it's necessary at some point, then yeah, if we are established in the abidance and in seeing our unbelievability, and there's no fear, trepidation around that, then certainly we could do that. But like from Tibetan Buddhism, the goal is the rainbow body, right? Which is when the body dies, it turns into light. Basically, it shrinks down, either shrinks down into a tiny little figurine, or just disappears actually into light. And occasionally, like Padmasambhava, he didn't even die. He just turned his body into light, without dying at all. So, ultimately, of course, we can do this, but that's not our short-term goal. Okay, so our short-term goal, let's be very clear about this, is to abide in the seeing, the recognizing of our unbelievability, our ability to do the unbelievable, to function in an unbelievable way. People would say that Padmasambhava functioned in an unbelievable way. Absolutely, he did. We say, I can't believe that. That's just unbelievable. And yeah, he's doing it. So he's functioning in an unbelievable way. So our goal is to recognize and abide in the recognition of our unbelievability. Okay, so we're really clarifying it here. So don't try to turn your body into light. Okay, don't struggle with that. That could just happen if it's necessary. When you are totally comfortable or extremely comfortable in recognizing, I am pristine unbelievability, and abiding in that recognition, then at some point whatever needs to happen as far as helpfulness, this will simply happen. It will just seem as easy as breathing, really, yeah, or easier. It's no trouble at all, no trouble at all. So you have to get to no trouble at allness, okay, in just all directions, 360 degrees. If you just try to make it one direction of a light body, okay, this is not the goal. The goal is to be aware of saturated isness, 360 degree saturation. 360 degree saturation. Of I am pristine. 360 degree saturation of unbelievability. So anything at all that needs to happen will happen. So we don't have a goal of a light body or something like that. No. Because that's limiting. You know, that's our goal to do this miracle. That is not our goal at all. Our goal is just to abide in the recognition of this 360 degree pristine unbelievability. So it is very true that you should not try to cultivate miracles, Rather, cultivate this 360 degree allowance and acceptance of pristine unbelievability and just abide in that. Ramana Maharshi is a great example of this. He never tried to do miracles at all. Miracles just happen. He said, whatever will happen, will happen. So just all miracles happen and all around. It's just very miraculous. And yet he never took credit for anything or never just stopped just being quiet and silent like this. He's not, you see, he's just abiding in the saturated 360 degree pristine unbelievability. So this is our goal. This is our goal, very clearly. We're not trying to develop any cities, any miraculous powers at all. Absolutely not. Bypass all of that as a goal. This leads to great problems. And we're not going to even think about the problems. We know it leads to troubles. Aggrandizements, all sorts of stuff that we don't want. Our Dharma kings very clearly have exemplified the goal for us. That's why I'm adhering to these Dharma kings. They exemplify the goal. No particular interest in any power whatsoever, or ability whatsoever. Just whatever needs to happen will happen. No resistance to whatever needs to happen will happen. No resistance at all. 360 degree pristine unbelievability. I am 360 degree pristine saturated unbelievability. Abide in this recognition. This is our goal. Abidance in the seeing of this, the recognizing of it. This is our goal. So we know what our goal is now. This is very helpful. And since it's 360 degree, we don't need to judge or think about what's excluded and what's included, what our aim is, what our focus specifically. There's no specifics. It's 360 degree. It's all inclusive. So we don't need to go down the road of details and specifics. Specifically, what miracle are you trying to do? What power are you trying to do? No, it's 360 degree pristine unbelievability. That whatever happens, whenever it happens, is all equally okay with us. all miracles, all in all, always. All is all, always. And this is something the lesser goal-oriented or goal-orientation doesn't understand. Graduated goal-oriented endeavor inevitably is this graduated sort of effort, because they have these specific goals. I want to, you know, have this power. I want to be able to do this, that kind of stuff. See, we're sidestepping that. We're beyond that. That's never a goal here. We're never trying to develop anything. Are just the one goal of abiding in the recognition of 360 degree saturated, pristinely saturated unbelievability. Ability that's simply unbelievable, plain and simple. So this is why my golf swing is right now, and right from the beginning, it's right. Because I understand it's not the wrists and the arms, it's the torque of the body and the pull of the body, pulling all that through. Using the big muscles of the body, as Jack Nicklaus used to say, and pulling it through like that. That's how it's really done. But you have to be strong to do that. I mean, sure, Jack Nicklaus could do it. He's built like an oak tree. So if you're weak, you end up getting all arms and wrists and fingers, and because you still have some strength in your fingers and hands, and so you try to, you know, but that gets you into trouble. That's like trying to develop spiritual power. Sure, sometimes you'll seem like, oh, people think you're a great saint and all this. And they'll come to you for all these miracles, but you're not helping them out of their arrogance so much, you know, and then they try to pigeonhole you, and anyway, it's a slippery slope, very slippery. It's not how it's really done. You got to go for the real 360 degree fundamentals here of just abiding in the recognition. And if miracles happen, they happen. Don't need to take credit for them. Let the Dharma kings take credit for them. It's dangerous for us to take credit for them. Let the Holy Spirit take credit. Jesus didn't even take credit. He said, this, your faith made you whole. So, of course, miracles will happen. People will think you're miraculous. You just don't take credit for him at all. It's just whatever happens will happen, whatever is destined to not happen will not happen. Just don't come out of abidance to explain, or, you know, just stay in abidance. Just keep the goal so people, role models, so people can see this is the goal. So helping out these Dharma kings is we're helping people see what the goal really is. This is what they want. Dharma Prince is someone who's very helpful in that, of putting the focus on what the goal really is, and using the Dharma kings as exemplars of the goal. They're perfect exemplars of it. I cannot be, you know, as a great exemplar as they were at this point. So I understand that, because, you know, they came out of the gate this way, basically, right? Yeah. Absolutely. They were born, they're emanations of this, born to play this role. But I can certainly align with this. I can certainly align with it. And we can do this, we can align with it. So this may seem to be difficult, yeah. Climbing that staircase, a stairway to heaven, so to speak. I mean, it seemed just out in space. It just, wow. It wasn't easy. And then dealing with this hysterical woman in red was not easy at all. She refused to, you couldn't talk with her, you couldn't reason with her, she just was inconsolable. She said, I just can't stand being here. I can't stand it, I can't stand it, I can't stand it. That wasn't easy. And so recognizing what's going to come in this world, the weirdness to come, that's not easy. But you know, we better do it. We can put up with a little difficulty and discomfort right now. Now, hanging out or aligning with the core of the Dharma King, the core of the Dharma Kings, is very helpful and important because it helps establish what the goal really is for us. Okay, so if we know what the goal is, then we can know what the practice is, right? Teresa goal. Therefore, we have a center to our lives that no amount of cyber attack or, you know, fake alien invasion or, you know, this and this and that or whatever may be coming. Nothing that can happen can really unseat us. Because we say, well, I still know what my goal is, what my purpose in life is, what my goal is. And therefore, I know what my practice needs to be. So how am I unseated? I'm not unseated. I did this video last night. I had tried to render it overnight. It failed. I had a feeling it would fail. And maybe some of it rendered, I don't know how much. I could start trouble from the beginning. It was probably too intense. Maybe the Holy Spirit only wants me to put out a little bit of it at a time. It was like 30 minutes of it or something. It's like, wow, too much. Too much. So maybe some of it rendered, I can put that out for you. So maybe just these little tidbits, 4 minutes, 5 minutes, is enough, you know, to quit your feet and say, okay. The sublime, I can get used to the sublime. This is just crude, you know, it's crude encouragement towards the sublime, but you know, it's like getting out on a golf course that's like a municipal, ratty municipal course. You know, it's something. And you see some, oh, there's a nice lake, but it's a bunch of algae, or it's kind of muddy, doesn't look nice, and, you know, it's a bunch of ratty Bermuda grass, and it's just, yeah, yuck, you know, but, yeah, maybe it's a nice green here, and this, you kind of get a little feel, but it's not the same as getting out on some ultra-exclusive private course. That's just like, wow, do I really even need to play here? I don't want to even take a divot, you know, there's like no divots anywhere, or I don't want to take a divot. Get your feet wet. So, and then you start feeling, you know, maybe I can go on a better course, and then maybe I can go to an even better course, and you know, one day you find yourself on this super golf course. It's been a while for me, actually. Although, It's not easy. It's not easy. You get nervous. Everything's too perfect. It's like, oh, I might mess it up. You know, I might mess something up. Oh, I don't want to put a smudge in anything here. But, and we'll see how it goes. Well, so I was out on a course that was actually pretty fabulous. How long ago? From November, December, January, February, March, April. So it's been five and a half months. Shoot, that's terrible. That's horrible. So it's been 5.5 months for me. And I haven't played much at all recently. The emergency is so severe, I stopped even trying to play golf. Forget it. We need to every moment be full on right here. It'll come at some point. I don't know. It's just the way it is, right? I mean, it's ideal time right now, but Holy Spirit says just keep, you know, you've got to keep all out here effort. And when it gives me a heads up, okay, it's fine. I just have to put up with that. I just dropped everything in my life. I don't follow sports anymore. I don't watch sports. I don't follow sports. Don't watch news. Don't follow news. Don't participate in recreation. Don't do anything except stretch, work out a bit, and tape and study and work and try to sleep a little bit and eat and just really just going into the very bare bones of the heart of it and letting everything else go. And so this is what I'm doing and setting example by doing this. It's necessary as we get really close here to the crisis, world crisis. And again, it will seem really weird and nobody will quite understand what's going on. This is what I've seen. It'll be so complicated and complex that forget about trying to figure it out. Forget about trying to figure out 9/11 out. This will be way, way weirder than that. They've really gone down the rabbit hole on this one. But we don't need to figure it out, right? Is that our goal, to figure out who the bad guys are or something? No. Our goal is to abide in the recognition of this 360-degree, pristinely saturated unbelievability. That I am that. That's our goal, to realize I am that. I am that 360-degree, pristinely saturated unbelievability. I am that. So that's our goal. And then our practice is then related to reaching this goal. That's my purpose. That's my mental focus. That's it. So we just have to stay in that seat. This is absolutely necessary. If we start trying to chase down the bad guys and trying to worry about who did what, then we're lost. If we start trying to blame, punish, we got to bring the perpetrators to justice and punish them, then that's what we're doing. And we completely lose sight of our real purpose here, which is to help all beings be liberated from arrogance, the aimlessness of arrogance. It's completely aimless. That's my goal. And all this aimless arrogance is just what? It's all equally aimless. And nothing happens at all if it's not our desire to experience this happening. So there's no one to blame. Thanks to Jesus, of course, and Meryl's pointing this out. There's no guilt. There's no blame. Nothing happens at all except that we desire to experience this happening. Now, we set it up to hide this fact because we're trying to say that reality isn't real. So we make it seem as if somebody else is doing something to us. But this is not true, actually. But we're all acting out like actresses, actors, pretending to make it seem as though all this stuff is happening, like that there's some dynamic outside of our minds forcing these upon us against our will. But nothing happens to us against our will, ever. Ever. It's impossible. But granted, we've certainly worked on a very, very clever illusion and I'm putting massive pretension into it, right? But this is all equally aimless. Arrogance is aimless. So we don't need to catch the perpetrators, so to speak, or say, oh, the bad. There's no bad. Bad consciousness, good consciousness, it's all equally aimless. It's the isness, the unscriptedness. Trying to script is aimlessness. Trying to script reality is total aimlessness, arrogant aimlessness. We're searching for an aim, We're trying to aim, trying to find something to aim at. There's nothing to aim at. But we're pretending there's all sorts of stuff to aim at. So this drama, much ado about nothing, continues. We think there's something to aim at. The final effort to aim is aiming at the aimless. Aiming at realizing 360-degree realization there's nothing to aim at. So we're so used to trying to aim at something to realize there's nothing to aim at. The attempt to aim at something is aimlessness. I mean, it's that use of the word aimlessness, where in reality, you don't say reality is aimless. You say it's perfect freedom. It's all aim. There's always everything to aim at. So scientists say there's something specific. No, it's all is all always. Anyway, that's just a potential word confusion. Calling aimless, arrogance is aimlessness. It's we're looking for something to aim at. That's what we mean. It's futility. It's futility. So we're so used to that when we're experiencing, oh, there's nothing to aim at. There's always everything. How can there be anything specifically to aim at? It's kind of it's a big wow for us to see this. It's a wow to see reality. It's like a wow. It seems like a void in terms of, well, what do I aim at? You know, what nothing. But it's again, it's not a void. It's a complete fullness. We can't separate anything out from reality. Everything is always ornamentation of its own intrinsic spaciousness. You can't separate it out from its own intrinsic spaciousness. It's impossible. So we can't aim at something that is a thingness, is not just ornamentation of its own intrinsic spaciousness. There isn't any such situation there, at all. So we're searching for what doesn't exist. That's why it's an aimless search, a futile search. So abiding in this is a big wow. It's like, and that's like on those stairs in the dream. It seems foggy because you can't really see anything specifically. We're not aiming for anything specifically. It's 360 degree. And so our beliefs get foggy at that point. And we have to say, no. That's okay. I am that pristine 360 degree unbelievability, the ability to recognize beyond belief. It's recording. Okay, we'll see if it uploads. That's the question. Nothing would upload last night. Well, really, everything has suddenly become dysfunctional. I think this was a heads up. So yeah, as long as we understand how not to be unseated, we don't need to stick our head in the sand either. You know, we're not trying to do that. It can be a slippery slope, and our habits are prone to, you know, play detective. You know, but we're not playing detective here. It doesn't matter what actors are playing the roles at all. It's that these roles are being played because we're desiring for them to be played. Try to give purpose to arrogance. That's all. So it has to be looked at from this level. We can never be resolved at the level of the acting, of the pretense. Because then we get into the blame game. We never can reach our goal by engaging in the blame game. That actually sabotages us. So I don't feel anger or upset or anything like that. That's not part of what we're doing. We're seeing beyond that. I have the ability to see beyond that. See, I am that pristine unbelievability. I have the ability to see beyond the aimlessness of arrogance. Arrogant aimlessness, searching for something to aim at. So it's super important not to get pulled down into negativity, but stay with a super positivity. Positivity is not enough. Never is enough. Always it has to be super positivity. Okay? Because positivity is subject to negativity. But super positivity is abidance in recognition of pristine unbelievability. And we're not trying to aim at anything specific miracle, right? It's we realize that everything's always in play. Always in play. There's nothing ever excluded. We're aiming to exclude something. Let's exclude the bad guy, the bad girl, you know. Let's exclude. Nothing's ever excluded from reality. 360-degree inclusion. Absolute inclusion. Unbelievability. Inclusiveness. Unbelievable inclusibility. Inclusibility, yeah. Unbelievable inclusibility. Pristine 360-degree inclusibility. Abide in that recognition. This is what we're doing. So we're not playing detective. We're not playing cop. We're not playing gotcha. We're not playing that game. That's a losing game. It's a game of frustration. People think they'll be happy if they just catch the perpetrators and execute them. You know, that's never brought about liberation from delusion. Happiness only comes from 360-degree inclusibility. That's it. In no other way. In no other way. Everything else is just frustration. And all the misery that comes with frustration. Uncountable. It's just astonishing, right? You think there's some end to the misery. There isn't. There isn't. As long as you keep maintain arrogance, there's no end to the styles of pretense. Pretend misery. There's no end to the misery we experience. We become almost fascinated with it, right? Yeah. Wow, look at this suffering. Wow, look at this. I've gone through so much suffering because I was intrigued by it, fascinated by it. I said, I wonder what kind of suffering, you know, I wonder how severe it is. I wonder how much it will be. You know, it's like, and you know, you get bit. You keep getting bit. Like, wow, it's amazing, isn't it? As always, it the way it happens is there's a very powerful cabal behind the scenes, who are scripting the whole thing, and then there's scapegoats. There's front people they use as scapegoats to act like the perpetrators. This is how it always works. So the blame will be put on them, and the real perpetrators will go unseen, right? And it makes it smoother for them. And this is how it works. Just like Oswald saying, I was set up. I'm a patsy. Yeah. Of course. So they play some role, enough role that it seems like in 9/11, you know, maybe there was, you know, some people flying airplanes into the buildings and stuff. But they were just patsies. They were just being used to hide the real perpetration. Which may very well have been, you know, World Trade Center number 7. That's where all the secrets really wanted to get rid of. And so the collapsing of World Trade Center 1 and 2 gave the cover they needed to demo World Trade number 7. They most likely demoed the other two also, but by having planes crash into them, it made it seem like they fell just from the fire within the building. So then they could light a fire in World Trade Center number 7, office fire, and then have it, and then demo it, and have it collapse too, and then say, oh, you see, well, and it kind of covered up the whole thing, made it seem like plausible that it, but if you look at it, it's ridiculous. So this is how they operate. This is how our pretension operates. It misdirects blame. It misdirects blame. But so what? If you find out who's really doing blame, how does that change anything? Doesn't stop it from happening. And this is how pretense works. There's always keep working this way. It's as long as we, you know, keep trying to make arrogance work for us, we'll keep getting bitten by arrogance. That's all there is to it. It will always happen in a way that catches us by surprise, seemingly, because we're complicit in it. We're complicit, but we're not caught by surprise by what's coming here, because we're not really complicit in it. We know that most of the world will be caught by surprise, and they'll go through this huge witch hunt, and just the agitation will just be off the charts. But we're not going to be part of that. This is just all much ado about nothing, a silly, silly drama that they're using to cover up their arrogance and say, well, no, we're not arrogant. We just have a complex goal here we're trying to reach. You see, if you see that it's impossible, then that shows that we've been arrogant. We're trying to arrogate a quality to ourselves we don't have, which is prime creator. Oh, you say, okay, I try to do that. I can't do that. Fine. Let go of it. That's the end of it. But when we say it's complex instead of impossible, then this hides the arrogance, doesn't it? Because then we can say, no, it's just someone's interfering. There's interference going on. The bad guys are interfering. Well, we need the bad guys to interfere. Otherwise, we'd recognize it's our own arrogance. So if we are complicit in it all, keep this in mind. Because by making screwing everything up, we say, we had this goal, it's really complex, and then this chaos came about. Someone's blocked us by sabotaging, and we just got to get back to working on it again and restructuring. And then that makes it seem that it's complex, but somebody's just interfering with our success. So that hides the impossibility of it. And that hides our arrogance. So we can keep arrogating a quality of prime creator to ourselves and not recognize that it isn't true. So we keep playing this silly game. It's a silly game we're playing. But this is what's really going on. So you have to be really honest. Honesty is super important. They were all complicit in this, in terms of this hiding arrogance from ourselves until we repent. So repentance is absolutely essential. You have to, at some level, realize nothing has ever happened to me that I didn't, my will didn't desire for it to happen. And it's the same with everyone. And so blaming anyone for anything is ridiculous. There is no guilt. Forgiveness, there's nothing to forgive. The final judgment is to recognizing there's nothing to judge. That's true. That's what Jesus has said. He said the final judgment is not God's judgment upon you, it's your judgment upon yourself. Of recognizing that there's nothing to judge at all, nothing to forgive at all. Nothing ever happened to me. It's always been my freedom at play, always. Same with everyone. That's the final judgment. So final judgment is a judgment we make that there's nothing to judge. So I have a lot of experience in not getting involved in these mega crises because I knew about them ahead of time, because I had repented, and therefore when you repent, you're able to work on yourself, so you're not complicit in this stuff. You say, I don't really need to go along with this scenario. So you then become aware of the intention ahead of time. As I was aware of 9/11 a couple years ahead of time. I was aware of the basic outline of what the plan was, what they were planning, what the mind, what the drama, the scripting of a drama was what they were up to. Just the outlines of it, the basic outlines. That, and I said, okay, wow, that's not good. That's going to cause a lot of trouble. And it did. But I was aware of it all, so I was able to then. And so when it happened, I didn't pay any attention to it. I said, I knew there's going to be all this witch hunt, all this confusion, misdirection. I already knew. I said, I'm not going to even engage in that at all. So I really never did. You know, way down the line, I basically, you know, just people began to realize it's not what, you know, there's diversion and there's someone, planners behind the scene and demolition and all that stuff. They put the pieces together. But I never felt that was a need. You know, it's just like, so what? You know, how does that liberate us from delusion, arrogance? It doesn't. So I never got wrapped up in it. I never even watched any of the video for years and years and years. Just I, I said, okay, that's what I was aware was going to happen. It happened. Let me just go, keep it going straight and stay with my spiritual practice. So did that. Proved it's possible. Same thing with like the tsunami, you know, both tsunamis. I really didn't pay attention to them. The, you know, the, what was that? The Gulf oil spill. Paid a little bit of attention to that and then stopped. I can't remember the name of that. There's been just all the stuff that happens. I really don't pay attention to it, and I don't try to assess blame or anything. It's just us doing our little silly dance of avoiding repentance. That's all. Just more avoidance of repentance is all it is, which we have to use confusion and complexity to do that. So that's all you have to judge. That's just what it is. We're just avoiding repentance. When you have a lack of complexity and a lack of confusion and crisis and all this catastrophe and all this, what happens is this helps you repent. You begin to look at yourself, say, wow, and begin to see it. So that's why a stable, nice, calm, stable, like area, like where I live, it's been very calm, stable, so to speak. I mean, there's been the, you know, Silicon Valley madness, I guess, that was been hell. But just living where I live, it's just suburbia. It's just nothing happens. It's just, so, you know, there's no catastrophes. A cat getting stuck in the tree is maybe a catastrophe here. We go, wow, this, what? You know, it's like, but mostly my life has been very boring, very dull. But this really helps repentance. It really helps it a lot. It's extremely difficult in an area where all these wars and catastrophes are happening. But that's by design. This designs to not repent. So you'll be so caught up in all this stuff, you won't repent. Whereas just being, you know, white bread in a, you know, white bread suburb is so boring. It's just like so boring, but so helpful. So helpful. You know, after 7 o'clock, you know, eight, nothing happens. There's no nightlife. There's nothing. You better be able to keep your mind engaged, or just the boredom will drive you crazy if you're used to action. It was tough for me because in my previous life I lived in Vienna, and the nightlife never stops there. It's like living in New York. So to have nothing going on at all, it's just like, what? This is crazy. So I actually tried to get stuff going on. You know, let's have concerts. Let's have culture. Let's have activity. You know, let's have diversion. But it didn't work. So if I didn't, you know, start studying the path and get engaged with the path, that would have driven me crazy. Boredom had just become brutal. Thanks to God, A Course in Miracles came along. That saved me. I said, wow, this is going to keep me busy for a while. And it's still keeping me busy. Along with the other Dharma case. Yeah. That saved my life. Jesus saved my life. Absolutely. Saved me from suicidal life for sure. I couldn't take it. I just had to, you know, had to have more action. I was used to, you know, Vienna. It's like a center of action, really. Especially back in the 19th century. I mean, it was happening. That Paris and Vienna, you know, those are happening places. I mean, let's go waltz, you know, let's go to a concert in the park. Let's go out and eat. Let's go out and revel. Let's go out in the nightlife. Let's, you know, festival, fiesta, all night long. What is that? Lionel Richie or something. Yeah. So the absolute lack of all that was like, just like a nuclear reaction in my experiencing. So A Course in Miracles came along. I said, this is a real challenge. Wow. And that kept me busy for 15 years, just totally busy on that. And then Anandamayi Ma came along and kept me busy for another, you know, 10 kept me busy for a crucial period of time, starting in October 27th, 1997. Up to like 2004, 5. So almost, you know, it was 10 years, but it's still going. But she really kept me super busy. When the Course in Miracles, I kind of had done enough of it as far as the words of it go. Then I still needed to be kept busy somehow. So she kept me really busy. That's for sure. Kept me, you know, away from the nightlife, away from the diversions, away from the ambitions, away from made the spiritual path, you know, not seem so boring, that engaging with it was really very more interesting than what's going on in the world. These things kept me away from all the, you know, social troubles and the complexity and the confusion of the world and the witch hunts, and kept me away from all that stuff. Longchenpa has come along now and helped me stay engaged at a very precarious time where it's very tempting to go on a witch hunt. You see it, I mean, the internet, you see it, I mean, just on YouTube, it's just like, it's just horrible. You know, and all the videos I've done, I've always acknowledged, yeah, there's trouble coming, but going on a witch hunt is absolutely the wrong way to go about it. So I started out like Clarity Ross channel, Clarity Ross, I think. I said, yeah, all these disasters, all these problems, yes, it's true. And all these conspiracies, yeah, they're true. And all this is true. But trying to, you know, attack and go on witch hunts and all this stuff, this is the wrong way. Is absolutely the wrong way to go about it. So I've always been an advocate, outspoken about all of this. So I have a track record for sure about speaking up on this. And you know, a lot of people didn't like that. I lost a lot of viewers because, you know, they were all about, you know, let's defeat these terrible, hideous people. And it's all polarization game, right? And they totally miss repentance. It's all about repentance. So I was willing to speak up about this, even though I know a lot of people didn't like it, and you know, they would stop listening. But you have to say this. It's all about repentance and recognizing our own arrogance and dropping our own arrogance. Don't worry about someone else's arrogance. We'll worry about our own arrogance. Be the change in the world that you want. Someone just told me that, I think Friday. He says, my perspective on the world is you be the change that you want to see in the world. And someone else told me their philosophy is, just let everything be as it is. That's when I'm happiest. And also, this is true. You be the change. And of course, that song, what was that, Michael Jackson? If you want to be want to make change in the world, just take a look in the mirror and be that change. Yeah. I'm looking at the man in the mirror. I'm trying to, you know. He had a rough time, didn't he? Didn't take his own advice. There's the problem with entertainers, is they get caught up in their own talent so much of being entertain people and bring smiles to people's faces, they feel that they're obligated to do so, but they're not obligated to do so. Or he was you know, just a great entertainer, Michael Jackson, for sure. There's no doubt about it. But look what happened. wasn't grounded in the right goal, the right purpose. It's our own arrogance. We have to be grounded in repentance, in a practice abiding in the recognition, 360-degree pristine unbelievability, that I am that. That arrogance is impossible. It's just wandering aimlessly about, looking for something to aim at. There's nothing to aim at. It's only God everywhere. And then having our practice focus on that. Get us, what do we need to practice in order to have that abidance? This is our focus. So be seated in the seat of repentance is where we have to be seated in. To be seated in the seat of repentance. And realize this is all, it's all been arrogance. Nothing, no one has ever done anything to me. Not one thing has ever happened to me. And not one thing has ever happened to anyone. And really, that's the crux of it. There's no matter at all. Matter is the belief that something can happen to us. Nothing can happen to us. We think there's a world happening to us. There's no world happening to us. It's 100% pretense. Nothing has ever happened. It's all been pretense, 100% pretense. Now that lady in red in the dream, she couldn't handle this. She's used to spreading the vicious lies of abuse and all this stuff. That's the stuff of complexity and confusion and arrogance. She has not repented. She was not a repentant figure. She was non-repentant. So they keep spreading the lies, is all they do. The lies of victimhood. And collectively we can get rid of victimhood by, you know, stamping it out and making sure nothing can happen to us. This is the root of delusion. Nothing can happen to us. Nothing has ever happened to us. It's impossible that anything happened to us. So the delusion of collectively we're going to go on this crusade to get rid of victimization is that's the heart of arrogance. That's the ugliness of arrogance right there. That's the ugly face of arrogance. Because this is saying that it can happen to us. And that's denying reality, total denial of reality. So that is the ugly face of arrogance. These crusades led by these, you know, figures of purity, that we're pure and we're righteous, that actually is the ugly face of arrogance. It's not the pretty face, it's the ugly face. Very ugly face. And we've been staring at this ugly face trying to convince ourselves it's pretty. It's not. Very ugly. I remember someone walking by ringing a bell or something. I remember I had this dream of this goddess, and this beautiful goddess, and then I suddenly saw her as she really was. She was incredibly ugly. This righteous goddess, leader of this purity, of purifying matter, purifying the world, getting rid of the bad guys, the victimizers, and making the world free of victimization, all this stuff, you know, the yoga girl stuff. I saw the figurehead of all this, and I suddenly saw her as she really was, this wrinkled old crone, this hideous-looking witch. It's like, oh my God. But then later, she said, great. This is great. I'm glad you saw that. Because it's the grace of God to see it, isn't it? Seeing the ugly face for what it is very, very liberating, actually. So it's all the righteous ones who are, that is the ugly face of arrogance, actually. Didn't Jesus point this out over and over again? The righteous Pharisees, all these righteous ones doing so much charity work and so much purifying the world, trying to make things everyone happy. They're so wonderfully righteous. He said, no. They don't get into the kingdom of heaven at all. He made it very clear. He was so clear about this. It astonished everybody. They didn't know what he was talking about. That's actually the ugly face of arrogance. Very ugly face. Because it's extremely unrepentant, isn't it? They say, we don't need to repent. What are you talking about? We're purifying the world. Who wants us to stop purifying the world? That's crazy. We can't repent. What do you mean? We're not arrogant. We're righteous. And so they're the ones who refuse repentance to the highest extent, to the worst extent. They're the ones saying, I was sexually molested when I was young. I was victimized by my uncle. I was this and that, you know. They're the ones who, my stepfather, you know, who was always some, you know, my father's friend. I was, you know, raped. I was victimized. I was all this stuff, you know. But I learned, you know, how terrible men can be and how terrible it is. And I realized how to be strong. And I'm going to change the world. I'm going to make sure that can never happen to anyone else again, you know. And so they become this huge righteous figure in the world that everybody rallies around their righteousness, righteous anger, righteous indignation. That's the ugly face of arrogance, actually. That is total lies, because nothing ever happens to us. Now, we're not denying that a pretentious drama took place, okay? And I'm aware of this. I'm aware of it because there have been attempts to lure me into playing this role. Okay, this is how the world works, actually. And you probably have experienced this as well. I don't know, very few in the world probably have not. Where, you know, I've experienced this in many different ways. I allowed myself to look at this and see, and I could see I saw the whole setup. How it works, how you're supposed to be the fall guy and take the blame for what's really a consensual, intentional, pretentious drama to try to promote the idea of victimization, that stuff can happen to you. Absolutely. And, you know, women are very, some, not all, but some are very, very much this way into this. I've talked about in previous videos, I've had these experiences. It's just like, wow. And when you don't go along with it, they get very angry. It's like they, you know, they say, "Here, you have to abuse me, victim, make me the victim," and that's your role. You have to rape me. That's your role. Yeah, I said, not now. Maybe later. You know, you can use that one, okay? I said, "Well, I'm not really gonna do that right now. I'm not really gonna do it now, but you know, maybe later. I might consider it later, but not now." So I was able to push that off. But I had the situation where this woman was absolutely demanding it. Just like, she's going to like kill me if I didn't, basically. Because she was so into this role of playing the victim, so she could get guilt, to use guilt as a leverage to become some righteous figurehead, you know. And I became very aware of what's going on. I'm just saying, wow. And she's like so angry at me that I wouldn't play this role, you know, so upset. Man, I get many, many, many situations similar like that. Which is, you know, it's like, well, I say women can be very dangerous from a man's standpoint. Very dangerous indeed. Because they can very, very adamantly demand that men play the role of the victimizer. When men don't want to. And women can be so vicious about this that the man just like becomes unnerved. He says, well, I better do it or I'm just going to be like have a nervous breakdown. That's why there are a lot of men in prison say, hey, wait a minute. I'm the patsy here. I'm the fall guy. Why? This is not fair. And that is true. However, they feel that actually prison protects them from these women. And they'd rather be in prison than not, to tell you the truth. Okay, guys, if you happen to be in prison watching this video, you're in prison because you feel it's safer than not being in prison. And I understand it. I get that. I get it. And it goes both ways, but generally speaking, it's the man that plays the role of the victimizer, and the woman plays the role of the victim. Then she can get all this righteousness out of that and be figurehead and lead this purification of impure matter thing, which is, that's the ugly face of arrogance. That's all it is. It's avoiding repentance. That's all it is. So, yeah, you in prison, you get all these guys in prison. They all say, I'm innocent. I go, what the heck? Well, you know what? This is true. It's true. They are innocent. But they're in jail because they feel it's safer there. They don't want to have to face that again. And when they get out of jail, what happens? Recidivism, right? Because they don't have the tools to avoid that. And so someone else wants to play the victim, says, hey, you know, you're good at playing this role. I know you're good at playing this role. So this is the role. I'm demanding you play this role, or else I'm going to call the goddess down on you to annihilate you. Or something. They threaten you very severely with all sorts of spiritual threats of you know, loss of your soul, your spirit, and all this stuff. And the guy goes, okay, I got no choice. Otherwise, their nerves are all shattered. They'll drink alcohol, take drugs to try to keep their nerves together. And then they lose their common sense and they start making bad decisions. Then they act out this pretension drama of victimizer and victim. And then back in jail where they feel, boy, I don't want to go through that again. Yeah, this is the whole setup here. It actually is. It actually is. And you know, nobody believes these guys. I do. Because I know exactly what's happening. And some women have actually gone through this from their angle of being the victim and seen that they set the whole thing up, and they demanded this drama take place, and the men agreed to it, and they actually admitted this. There was some woman back in the 70s wrote a book about that and came clean about it. Never heard from her again. Say the least, the sisterhood didn't like that. the righteous sisterhood, the ugly face of arrogance, did not like that in the slightest bit. It was a Jewish lady named Sophie something, I think. She admitted it. She said, I saw it. I saw how I set everything up and convinced the man to play this role. Got him, you know, on drugs and everything, and broke down his will to say no to it. And then it did go through. But then everyone's telling me, oh, you're such a terrible victim. This is hideous. You know, got to persecute this guy. He's a vicious rapist and all this stuff. She said, no. I set the whole thing up, broke down his will, insisted he play this role. And I did it because I wanted to see what it's all about. And now I see it, you know, and said, no, I'm not going to persecute. I'm not going to blame him at all. I'm completely responsible for what I experienced. That's right. There was a woman who wrote a book about that. Now, there's a real heroine. There's a repentant soul right there, you know. Hopefully she kept her repentance going. But, boy, did the radical feminists go crazy about that one. She lost her, you know, radical feminist card with that one. Got kicked out of the sisterhood. Maybe they had her repent, and, you know, from repentance to bring her back into the fold. But this is true. What she was speaking was truth. She didn't persecute. She didn't lay a guilt trip on the guy. You know, she did not. And there are a lot of women who have not. That they back in the 60s and 70s, women were realizing the role that they played. They were honest back then, more honest. And they're saying, guess what, guys? You've really never victimized us at all. But then at some point, they got all frightened. Like, then they think that, well, that means men can just do whatever they want to with them. But that's not true at all, because they're totally in control of their own experiencing. So nothing can happen to them they don't want to have happen. The idea that all men are going to suddenly become rapists if women admit that nothing bad can happen to them is ridiculous. But that's the lie that the feminists have perpetrated, that what happened was, they say, if we keep admitting the truth of this, men will just say, oh, wow, you know, we can just do whatever we want to do. That's ridiculous. Because what they're admitting is they're totally in control of their own experiencing. So what they were just admitting is that they might want to go wild and crazy, okay, and get out of control. So they had to have this radical feminism to keep themselves in control, control of themselves, because they saw within them this sort of this wildness. Women had this inner wildness to them that they're very frightened of, and you know, men are frightened of it too. They can be very, very frenzied and ecstatic. Actually, the mind is in a lot of the ancient religions, the women were the ones who were just going to the frenzies. You know, they're just ferocious. But men don't have to go along with that. You see, we say, no, maybe later we'll get into that. I'm not interested in it right now. So what they were missing was repentance. They weren't repentant enough. So that's what resulted in feminism, radical feminism. So first there was this honesty, and then there was a fear of their own wild spirit, kind of, which is their own freedom, but in a physical context. So they put it in a physical context was the mistake they made. And then they didn't have enough repentance to work this out and look, say, wait a minute, you know. I'm not a physical being at all. There's no such thing as matter at all. If they really looked at and repented from arrogance, they'd realize there's no world at all. And then therefore they wouldn't feel so threatened by their freedom, because they wouldn't have to act it out in a physical, sexual, body sort of way at all. But they didn't have enough of that repentance. This led to radical feminism, and then the whole thing about we got to protect ourselves from men because that might tempt us to become wild. You know, so let's put all men in jail and let's deny, you know, let's be righteous. The whole thing came from a lack of repentance. This whole mess that we're in is a lack of repentance and a lack of a willingness to know what our goal really is. And then if we knew what our goal was, then our practices would be aligned with that. Instead, they tried to work out all this wildness and like sexual tantra and all this stuff. And, you know, it's devolved into the mess we have in the world today, really. They hooked up with, you know, crazy wisdom, quote-unquote gurus, or just a way for them to act out their own wildness physically, actually. And their wildness is just this fear of reality and the desire to then make as much physicality as possible. So just to become, you know, insanely physical, right? That comes up, especially in women, it tends to come up. It comes up in men also. But it tends to be stronger in women. You know, they just want, let's make, you know, trillions of babies, and let's let everybody just can be totally obsessed with sex and physicality and everything. And this, we feel, protects us from, you know, our freedom, our real freedom. So they react. It's a reaction to seeing freedom without being grounded in repentance. So we screwed up, you know, culture screwed up, no doubt about it. Paying the price, we'll pay the price for it going forward very severely. But hopefully some women have got on a path that's helping them with this. It seems as though that's possible. And they'll be able to stay grounded through what's coming up, but most not. You can see women are about ready to go nuts, go crazy, actually. And then, of course, project their own, you know, riotousness that's coming out onto men, saying that they're the ones to blame, and then try to crack down on men to try to prevent their own acting out of all this. And it's just going to be a mess, an absolute mess. It has been a mess for quite some time, actually. So for both men and women, you can say, well, you know, maybe this is something I could engage in, but not right now. Not right now. Right now, I know what my purpose is, and therefore I know what my practice need to be, so I'm seated in repentance. But maybe some other life I might, you know, act out these pretensional drama with you, you know, as possible. Don't take an absolute position on it. You'll fall. Then they have something, a tree to chop down, you see. These minids, bacchanalian mind, it's coming. It's coming. It's really coming. I mean, wow, the entitlement complex is so strong to this. So you must have this technique. Don't give them a tree to chop down, because they can and they will chop it down. either which way you want to go, male, female, female, male, 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 female, female, whatever you want to, however you want to look at it, don't give them a tree to chop down. Just say, well, you know, for the rest of this life, I'm not right now because I have a, I'm seated in repentance for this life, but in a distant life, some other life, yeah, I might consider engaging this in this pretentious drama. I mean, I'm not saying absolutely no to it. Don't give them a tree to chop down. Don't give them a position to attack, an absolute position to attack on this. This is the secret I'm sharing with you. It's key. It's key. This is how you stay seated in repentance. Because if you give them an absolute tree to chop down, it's too difficult to defend that position because we are not yet in the absolute knowingness, okay? So that would be, so we're going to feel unstable, insecure, and they can start working on our instability, chopping the tree down. So we're not admitting to any absolute position yet because all we have is, and we're attempting to abide in the recognition of pristine, 360-degree pristine unbelievability. Okay. We're attempting to abide in that recognition. But that is still perception. It's not knowing. And Jesus says, you cannot have knowing here and stay in this realm. You cannot. So the highest you can get is this healed perception, he calls it. Which is abiding in the recognition. That is healed perception. So it's not knowing. So if we take a position, say, I know that I'm not going to do this, we're taking a position where we ourselves cannot really back that up. And we're not convincing because, so don't take an absolute position. Just say, not right now, but maybe later. Not right now, but maybe later. When sickness tries to come, say, well, not right now, sickness, but maybe later I'll engage in that pretensional dance. I'm not taking an absolute position on it. It's possible I could engage in it at some other point. But right now I'm preoccupied. This is what really, it doesn't interest me now, but maybe later it might interest me. But for the rest of this life, I'm not going to be interested in that. I know what I really want for this life. And so put it like that. In a future life, yes, maybe. That's why understanding future lives is really helpful. In other words, very helpful. Because if you say, no, I'm not, this is life's the only life I have, and I'm not going to do this life, you're taking an absolute position. We're free to have another life if we want to. A physical dance of arrogance, of pretension. We're free to do that. We're free to do that. So absolutely possible I could. I'm not ruling it out absolutely. No. And in fact, we can't rule it out, anything out, absolutely, all is all, always. But, you know, the likelihood is we're not going to, once we truly know, we're not going to deny knowing again. that's very unlikely. We could, but, you know, it's a freedom, it's a choice we could make, but we're not going to say, you know, I'm not going to try and imprison myself. That's not much fun, actually. I got a lot of better stuff to do. In fact, everything is better. Infinite betterness. Infinite, endless betterness than that, trying to do that. Trying to deny reality is that's not that fun. So, we have the tools. We have the tools. We just have to use them. And, you know, you will be targeted. Everybody will be targeted coming up. So you better be seated in the seat of repentance. And realize all of this is just, it's been my own dance of arrogance. That's all it's been. Nothing else. And fortunately, I can see past that. I have that 360-degree unbelievability, and I can, my practice, my goal is to abide in this recognition of 360-degree pristine unbelievability. That's my goal for this life. And in order to do that, I have to be seated in the repentance of arrogance and recognize arrogance when I see it. And therefore, I'm not going to try to obscure it from my vision, which, going along with this little dance of pretense, of victimization, whatever it is an attempt to obscure it. So it's lack of repentance. So I'm not going to go off that in this life. Now, you know, some of the Tibetan Buddhists have got caught up in this, right? I mean, just because you're part of a religion doesn't mean that, you know, you're practicing all the keys necessarily at all. Some guru's been caught up in this. Yeah, absolutely. They came, especially came to the West, and the wild women of the West. You know, it was too much for them. They thought, oh, the women really want to learn spiritual truth. Okay, well, no, not really. They didn't. They wanted to have a cover for their wildness. They were so wild. They said, I need, like these pagan wild women. They said, I want to somehow give some righteousness to this. You know, and then the wildness came out, and the spiritual teachers got caught up in that. It's a really nasty trap. Not that Tibetan women don't have some wildness in them too. I'm sure they do. All women do. That's how arrogance comes up through the female form. You know, they just demand more form. You know, hey, I want to make more form here. That's all there is to it, Buster. You don't dare say no to that. Well, we say no right now, but it's not an absolute no. It's maybe later we might consider, but not right now. Ask any man right now, and I guarantee you they're terrified of women. Absolutely terrified. Because when women go down the warpath, it's terrifying. They can become very, 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 very wild indeed. As wild as men try to be, they're just amateurs at it. They're just amateurs at it. You know, it's just funny. I mean, men look at other men, and men are trying to be these wild men, you know. Putting face paint on, beating a drum in the jungle and all that stuff. And we just laugh at each other, you know. It's just like, you know, amateur hour. You know, who are you kidding? Come on. You know, combat, you know, G.I. Joe and stuff, you know. No, because you take them out of that thing and, you know, they're sitting in a sofa in front of the TV watching baseball or something, you know. They're just amateurs at it. And see, men recognize that in each other. That's who you're trying to get. And they can call them on it. Oh, yeah, you know, Mr. Wild Guy. Okay, right, yeah. I'm at a bar. I'm drinking. I drove to a bar on a motorcycle and drinking all this whiskey and, you know, all these wild women around and getting in fights and stuff. Say, yeah, okay, yeah. Whoopee, you know, big deal. Mr. Wild Guy, huh? Who are you trying to fool? You're just scared of women is what it is. You're scared of the wildness of women is what it is. Come on. They know it too. You can call them on it and they'll say, yeah, you're right. You're right. But you can't really call women on it. Men cannot really call women on this thing. Women can probably call each other on it. I don't know. They're not doing enough of that, but they certainly can be more outspoken about it. It's hard for women to fool women, right? They say, who are you trying to kid, you know? And especially when women claim this victimization thing. You know, it's other women that say, what are you talking about? You know, you asked for it. You know, this has been the battle. The real battle between feminism is really between women. It's been a war among women. They don't really care about men. They say, well, we can get women to do whatever we want to do. But the war has been between repentant women and non-repentant women. And men have just been on the sidelines, actually. Because, you know, women try to pull this victimization thing. And it's the other women would jump them and say, hey, you know, that's just, you know, you set it up. You wanted it. You got what you wanted. And that's what women used to, wise women knew this. Repentant women know this. And there were enough repentant women in society that they kept society in line. If you don't have repentant women, you cannot keep society in line. Men can't keep it in line. Forget about that. No way. They can't stand up to the unrepentant women. They cannot. Very few can, let's put it that way. This is prohibitively difficult. So it's women that fashion culture and society, because they have to keep the other women in line. If they don't, you have a collapse of civilization, and this is what's happening now. But that is no, you know, I'm not blaming repentant women at all, because they tried. I'm very aware they tried their best. They simply got overwhelmed from various factors that was too much for them. They weren't grounded enough in high wisdom. The extraterrestrial card messed them up, to say the least. Threw a curveball. Yeah, a lot of stuff really got thrown at them. Very, very severe stuff. You know, the serpent tempted Eve, so to speak. But they did fight against it, against feminism. They absolutely did. So, you know, all kudos and gratefulness, gratitude for that, absolutely. And it certainly helped me out enough. Just the fact they put up that fight was enough to help me out to get to where I am, too. If they hadn't put up any fight, I wouldn't be where I am now, actually. I would have gotten buried by it. But they may be into a situation now where they're very brittle and in despair and angry and you know, maybe even just saying cynical and stuff. So it's not like there's this huge body of women that are, you know, can lead the charge to truth. No, because they were still caught up in the matter, you know, the Christian false notion of dual nature of Jesus. Unfortunately, that got put in there by the materialists. And so they didn't have enough juice to win the battle. But that's okay, you know, you fought the good fight. It's greatly respected. Greatly honored and respected here. But that doesn't mean that I'm putting my faith that you can win the battle now. No. You got really crushed. But you can resurrect from that death. It's not a final death at all. But you have to get to the higher non-dual truth. So non-dual women can bring about a culture revival, could. But once you get non-dual, you realize it's not about women or men anymore, you see. So it is not about culture anymore. And they don't really demand, a non-dual woman doesn't demand that they be the ones who are in charge, actually. Which is why wisdom comes from wise women allow men to have roles of authority within that culture, because they know it works better that way. There's no culture. Just like who put Christians in position of power? Wise Jewish women put them in power. Who put the rabbis in power? Wise Jewish women did that. The men didn't put themselves in power. The women said, "This is okay with us. This is going to work out best. I see it. You know, that you have a adamant capacity for discipline and such, and you won't be bothered by childbirth and all this kind of stuff. And this is going to work best. So absolutely, this is how we want it to be, and we'll agree with it." That's what really happens. What's wrong with Christianity? There's not enough wise women anymore. There's not enough wise Jewish women in the world right at this point, you could say. Jewish women have the capacity to be very wise, but there's not enough of them in the world right now. A lot of them have gone materialistic. A lot of them have, actually. A lot of very powerful Jewish women in the world have gone materialistic, and they're being super successful at it. They figure, like, we can't win, so why not? You can't beat them, might as well join them. Type of thing. But they're not the only wise ones. There's a lot of wise Indian women too, a lot of wise Tibetan women, a lot of wise Chinese women, a lot of wise women, Japanese, all over. You know, yeah. But they've had the stuffing knocked out of them, actually. And they're kind of just saying, wow, can't really help you at this point. Well, enter the Dharma kings then. They can help us. Guess what, guys? We're not without help. We're not without help. The Dharma queen, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, has got our backs. If you want to look at a woman right there, she absolutely has our backs. And she placed us in charge of these Dharma kings. That's what she told. That's what she had me. She says, look, you need to go to these Dharma kings, and I authorize you to do that. And listen to them. Listen to them. I said, I'll do whatever you want me to do. And she said, well, you go listen to them. That's how I want you to follow. Go listen to Jesus Christ. Go listen to Ramana Maharshi. Go listen to Longchenpa. Do what they tell you to do. See, the Virgin Mary said to the servants that they didn't ask Jesus what to do with the wedding of Cana. They asked her. Jesus said, look, go fill the wine. She said, they came to her. She said, what should we do? Because they realized she was the power. Okay, and we've run out of wine. They didn't go to Jesus first and say, Jesus, what should we do? They went to his mother, be a wise, powerful, wise Jewish lady, and said, what do we do? What do we do? We're in a tough spot here. We've run out of wine. This is a huge wedding, important wedding. We've run out of wine. This is bad news. What do we do? And she said, you do what my son tells you to do. That's what you do. Whatever he tells you to do, you do it. You see how Virgin Mary empowered Christianity by saying, putting men in charge, say, you do what Jesus tells you to do, and then supporting that, you see? Because she knew that's the right way. And from that point on, Jesus was empowered. Is that not true? Because then he did the miracle of turning the wine and the water into wine, and started his mission of miracles, started at that point. So the quote-unquote Virgin Mary, in that way of looking at her, this is a helpful way of looking at it. It's just pointing out the dynamic, functionally, pragmatically. So, but that's just a principle. So Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma told me, I said, I'll do whatever you want to do. You're the boss, because I could tell you're there's nothing that you can't do. You have complete pragmatic awareness of everything here. All miracles are available to you. And I realized that there's nothing I can do in the world if women don't give consent, if the wise women don't give consent. You, as a man, you can't do it. You can't. They'll block it. And she said, okay, you have my consent. I want you to go to these Dharma kings and serve under them. Because again, our continuity fear is such that we keep defaulting back to the flesh. And the most powerful pretension of the flesh is the mother, the female. There's no way around that. It's just, of course, it has to be that way, right? So, because we don't know, we're vulnerable. Perception is vulnerable to a determined attempt to chop it down. So you, again, lacking an absolute position, we feel the vulnerability. Where Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma had an absolute position, she actually would go into knowing at times. Now Jesus said, you can't for long remain in this world if you're in knowing. And this is what happened. She'd have to come out of it. You couldn't remain here. So she related to us through the Sambho Gakkhaya, the healed perception body, the bliss body. But she said, above this bliss is the great bliss, but you can't really function here in the great bliss. Exactly what Jesus said. She actually showed us exactly the truth of this. So, but because of that knowing that she did bring, She could tell us authoritatively, you know, you can't reach that knowing. Therefore, you heal perception is the most you can have, but that can be vulnerable. You have to protect it. So, but I am telling you, this is what you need to do. You have my permission as a quote-unquote female presence coming from knowing that you as men and as everybody here absolutely have the absolute right, and this is what I tell you to do, is to go towards to heal perception. So, getting this permission from knowingness, also from a field figure, is very powerful. Because that's a recognition that the danger is indeed to be lured back into a non-fleshy position of non-repentance and to promote the flesh out of fear, out of continuity fear towards perfection, towards knowingness. And you have to counteract that by determined practice. That's the only way. That's what she said. Determined practice is the only way that works. And so I got this from her. Much of my determined practice is attributed to Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, because that's what she emphasized, is just practice, determined practice. You have to do it, you have to do it, you have to do it. No way around it. This is what I advise. She always came back to that. Whatever they asked her, she'd always loop it back to, well, what's your practice and how determined are you are? No matter what the question was. I need miracles. I need miracles. You say, okay, that's great, but what's your practice like, and how determined is it? I want you to tell me this. I want to know about that. You want a miracle? Okay, fine, but I want to know what your practice is like. She always looped whatever happened back to that, and then said, well, you want a miracle? Great. I want you to have your practice more determined, and then we'll see what happens. Now, did the miracle come? It did. If they decided, okay, we'll accept this deal, and they started practicing more determined, guess what? Miracles happened for them. The miracles they wanted, or better, happened for them. This is a fact. So this saved me from radical feminism. She saved me from it. The Course in Miracles saved me from suicide, of just the boredom in it saved me, saved my life. But Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma saved me from radical feminism, for sure. Because she says, look, I'm the ultimate. You want a woman authority? I'm the ultimate. Because I have knowing. And I can even bring that at times here. And I've showed you this. And I can drop dead as a rotting corpse in front of your face and then revive myself perfectly fresh again. And I did it. So I'm the authority here. And so I'm telling you, everything that you asked for me, I'm looping it back to your practice. What is your practice? She says, practice A Course in Miracles. Are you practicing it enough? She says, you're with Jesus Christ? Great. Do what he tells you to do. That's what she said. Do what he tells you to do. So she's like the Virgin Mary. It's the same sort of thing Virgin Mary says. Do what he tells you to do. Do what Jesus tells you to do. Do what Ramana Maharshi tells you to do. But she's like an ecumenical Virgin Mary. You know, she's not saying, she said, whatever is your path, I want you to practice better on that path. She was totally ecumenical. If you're Buddhist, great. You're Tibetan Buddhist, great. Who's your Lama? Okay, who's your guru? Practice how they tell you to practice, but do it better. Do it better. Be more committed to it. Be more determined to it. Be more adamant. Be more confident about it. You absolutely have my permission. I'll totally back you up on this, 100%. If you do this, I'll always have your back. That's why I believe she still has our back, still has my back. Even though I'm not aware so much of it, although she has come to me a number of times recently in dreams. But then she disappears again. But she has my back. Big time, all the way. Although whatever it takes, whatever miracle it takes, she can do it. She'll do it. She'll do it. There's no miracle she can't do. This is a fact. That's why I say she was the greatest guru ever. Because she literally, again, would go into knowing here. Her body would be like ice, death, drop, and be just like ice, completely dead. No heartbeat, no pulse, no breath, nothing. And she just remained in that state, like suspended animation. Her body would go into suspended animation when she went into the great bliss. And she did that many, many times. And there was absolutely no miracle that she could not do, she would not do. But what, you have to earn it. I mean, she'd say, you got to, you want a miracle? Fine. Well, let me see you increase your spiritual practice then. So she kind of make these deals like that. And so we couldn't resist. So she got me going on practicing because I was very lazy. I tried to intellectualize it and understand it intellectually. But she got me actually very determinedly working at it, you know, and ultimately practicing. She's the one that did that. Jesus certainly also got me, what he did was got me going fast and not, don't get stuck on words. Faster, faster, urgency. He gave me the sense of urgency and speed, and don't get hung up on the words. Just get the gist of it, get the gist of it, get the gist of it. But I still was conceptualizing it too much. And I didn't get down to the real nitty gritty until Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma came on the scene. And that's when I started really developing this intense work ethic, determination, everyday determination. I already had a lot of it from Jesus, but she you know, kicked me harder because she said, well, you know, hey, you want to be, you know, the victim of the plaything of radical feminists, the machine, you know, you want to be the machine of the radical feminists, because that's what's going to happen to you if you don't really get down to the nitty gritty here. And I said, wow. She said, which one? What would you rather have, me or the love goddess, you know, or you know the pagan goddess? Which one? I said, I'd rather have you. They said, well, okay, you better get down to work then. I said, who's more beautiful, me or these, you know, love goddesses? And I said, well, you are. Who's more attractive? I said, well, you are, no question about it. She says, okay, get down to work then. You got me, but you better get down to work or you'll lose me. And it's true. I mean, these radical feminists just use men. Men are just machines to them. Men are just machines. That's all they are. That's the culture that's coming. And men know it too, and they're scared out of their minds about it. And they're talking about it to one another. If you know, so they're kind of whispering it, actually. It's like, you know, it's like, I'm really scared. Yeah, men will just be, you know, boy toys. Super sexism is coming up, has come upon the world. Super sexism. And it's the women that are the sexist, very, very sexist, and demanding that men go according to the script, that they want to write the script of the flesh, which is just the belief in scriptedness, which is the belief in matter, demanding that men believe in matter and be the subsidiary slave class, that machines that just make the whole thing seem wonderful. So this is all known ahead of time. Again, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma said, who do you want, me or these pagan goddesses? You choose whichever one you want. And I said, I'll choose you. So it's a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer. And again, okay, great. Right choice, great choice. But you need to really, really apply yourself to the spiritual path. No more fooling around. No more halfway in it. You know, get really serious about it. So she outed the whole thing, the whole feminist thing, the whole pagan goddess. She outed it all for me. She showed me what it's all about. She has her ways of doing that. And I say, is that what you want? So here I am, you know, taping again, 2.5 hours, 3 hours, however long it takes, every day, grinding away all day. Thank her for it. Thank her for it. She's the one most responsible, I'd say, for that, the kind of work ethic I have. Now, most people are scared of that, right? But I couldn't help myself. Because here was truth itself. Yeah, I love truth so much, and here's an emanation of truth in the world. I just said, well, I couldn't help it. Just said, wow. Can't resist it. Couldn't resist. Could not resist. But yeah, it's scary because, you know, she can ask you, practice more. She uses her attractiveness to get you to practice more. It's like you're in her clutches, you know. It's like, oh man, I'd like to take it easy. Like, oh well, you know, I guess I'm going to disappear down. You know, what? No. Or, you know, she's going to send you to someone else. No, I don't want to be sent to someone else. Well, no, you got to. So they'll give you these skillful means. Longchenpa, so helpful. Ramana, so helpful. Jesus Christ, so helpful. Guys are really good. Men are really good at practicing. They're very good at it. Women tend to, they realize they have the power to get this. I'll have the men practice for me. They'll be a practice machine for me, and I'll just take it easy. It's more difficult for women to be disciplined in practice. Because they can always think like, well, I can get a man to do this for me, can't I? You know, that's how it works. Like, what am I doing here? There's got to be a guy around somewhere. You know, he can do this. What am I doing? I'm doing all this yard work. There's got to be a guy somewhere who can do this for me. That's always pops into their mind. Well, what else are men good for anyway? You know, I don't know what they're good for. Might as well have them do something they're good for. I can't see anything else they're good for. That's the battle that women have. So their battle is to practice determinedly. It's very difficult for women to maintain a determined practice. It's easier for men because men are under the gun. They're always under the gun, and they know that the consequences. You know, they'll be turned into slaves if they don't. Whereas women, they don't have that threat so much. You know, they don't. They can always say, I can always get some guy to do the dirty work for me. Always have in history, always have, right? That's how it works here. Always will, that's how it works. So it's tough for them to get this determined practice. But they can do it. They certainly can do it. They just have to be very alert and aware. Don't try to, you know, get the guy to do the dirty work for him. You know, they just have to say, I can't do that. Just cannot do that. And they may not want to have anything to do with a guy, even a male teacher, because they might start trying to get the teacher to do the dirty work for him, the difficult work for him, and try to set him up. And, you know, that absolutely can happen and does happen. It's a dangerous situation, actually. I think it's better for women to go to women teachers, probably. I don't know if this is true or not, but it seems that way, because the women teachers can see right through them and say, no, you got to do the work. Don't get this guy. Oh, you have a boyfriend, huh? No. You keep doing the determined effort here. You know, you look in the mirror. It's your arrogance. It's your repentance that you got to accomplish. You know, your boyfriend can't do that for you. Oh, but, you know, no, that's an excuse. So they're able to catch these guys. That's an excuse. And a real true woman teacher will probably send men to some male teacher, you know. Because men tend to, you know, just fall in love with the female teacher, you know, just this, and stop practice. I just don't need you're everything I need and want. You know, I don't need to, you know, and that doesn't work. That doesn't work. They have to practice and be disciplined and really skillfully look at abidance. Longchenpa is so great at abidance. He's so great at it, and that's our goal. Abidance is our goal. Abidance in the recognition of 100%, 360-degree pristine unbelievability. I am that. Abide in that. I am that. Longchenpa is so skillful at this. He's so great at it. He's so helpful at it. And I don't fall into this devotion thing with him, you know? No, it's a whole different feeling than with Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. To me, he's just a guy, you know? And he came to me just a guy. When he appeared to be, just, you know, lifeguard shirt on, bag, surf trucks, hey, I'm just a guy. I'm just a guy. Just like you. That's it. Then in Sambhogakaya, he gave me a Sambhogakaya bliss body appearance. That's like, wow. But still, he's not asking me anything. I'm just a guy. You can see me that way. That's so helpful. It is so very helpful. And so hopefully you're getting this ambience, you know. I'm just a guy. Longchenpa's just a guy. That's it. We're not caught up in devotional stuff like that here. Because we need skillful means and very clear seeing. What is it that's interfering, you know? Why am I giving away my abidance? What am I giving my abidance away to? The Tibetan Buddhists are all about skillful means. Super skillful means. And Longchenpa is the master of all those means. He is just great at it. He'll get us to it. He promised me this. He'll get us there. In fact, we're already there. He's already done it. He sees he's already done it. And Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, they're just cheering it all on. Saying, yes, yes, yes. Love it, love it, love it. She's just, you know, just blissing out on this. Just blissed out. Just, that's what she loves. But she recognized that getting too much into devotion, it leaves you wide open for the radical feminists and the pagan goddesses that they're bringing in, the self-righteous babes, you know, the victim status babes. And for a man, that leaves you very vulnerable. And I've seen that some men are getting, you know, caught up in that. They're getting caught by it. And they tried to catch me up in it, too. I said, well, not now, maybe later, you know, we can... Not going to do that right now, but maybe later. Yeah, I mean, if that really, it catches my interest later on, if that's really what I really want to do later on, I'll do it, but not right now. So that's why Anandamayi Ma, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma does not want for me to emphasize her too much in terms of pictures and things like that. She keeps blocking it. Because people will fall in love with her, you know, devotion. Just, if you get it, you see it. You're just like, wow, just knocks you out. Like the strongest wow you've ever felt, ever experienced. I was rendered absolutely speechless. Just tears streaming down my, out of my eyes, just speechless. Just, it just knocked into bliss. Just knocked me into bliss. It was the strongest wow I've ever experienced. First time I saw her, just absolutely stunned me into bliss. Just because I saw what was there. But she doesn't want that. You know, at this point, he said that's not advisable. It's not advisable for you. So pay attention to Longchenpa. She says, pay attention to Longchenpa. Pay attention to that guy. Yeah, he's a guy. He looks like he could have a Budweiser or something. You know, he's got a tank top on and baggies on the ocean there. It's just like, yeah. Not actually Budweiser, but, you know, glass of water, glass of juice, you know, some orange juice, some papaya orange juice. That's a good mix. Try a smoothie of papaya, orange juice, and coconut water. No, and pineapple juice. Here's a great smoothie. Okay. We just had one. Really great. Cut up a whole papaya. Right. Real ripe papaya. Let it get real ripe. Then scoop it all out. Take that and then two oranges. One whole papaya, two oranges. Freeze them. Okay. Then put that in a blender, smoothie blender. Put in a 8 ounces or 10 ounces or 12 ounces, whatever, of pineapple juice. Or actually, pineapple orange juice. Dole makes this pineapple orange juice, okay. Can of pineapple orange juice, and then put in some coconut water, okay. Blend that up, and then try that. That is awesome. That's probably the best smoothie I've ever tasted. What a blend, pineapple orange and papaya. Papaya orange, pineapple with coconut water. Now, we also tried by adding mango chunks to that. I didn't like that as much. Others did. They said they like mango, but I'm not a big fan of mango, actually. But the papaya one, wow. Holy cow. So Longchenpa's got a papaya, orange, and pineapple coconut water smoothie in his hand. And he's hanging out on the beach. And not really hanging out. He's standing on the beach there, lifeguard. Yeah, you talk to him. He's a guy. You can go talk to him. Hi, Longchenpa. Great to see you. How's everything? He said, well, everything's good and bad. Or neither good nor bad. I said, oh, great. Yeah, so he's just, you know, he's a guy. So what's the practice for today? Well, you know, let's look at this, how these aspects of this marketing campaign of arrogance, how those come unglued and you can let them go and you don't take them into practicing anymore. And that'll help you abide in the recognition of 300. Let's look at 360 degree pristine unbelievability. So let's try practicing this. Oh, okay. That sounds like a really good practice. Okay, let's focus in on this. And how about a little Sambhogakaya practice of your bliss body? He says, yeah, that'd be good too. Okay. It's like there's no baggage. It's just like, it's just do it. Longchenpa shows up. He says, okay, chief, you know, what's the practice for today? Let's start practicing. We're ready. We're ready for you, chief. Sambhogakaya practice. Okay. Let's get into that. Bliss body practice. Wordless practice. Gratitude practice. 360 degree practice. The self emanates its the isness presence, the bliss, the joy, the freedom, the isness presence. It emanates in 360 degree emanation, all equally, like the sun emanating its light. And so we practice this 360 degree pristine emanation practice of unbelievability, inclusibility, and we practice this, realizing the Sambhogakaya bliss body practice has this beautiful creativity, sublime creativity associated with it. So we practice these flowers. These beautiful flower frames, these you know, as beautiful as we can get, the flowingness, the beauty. We practice being impacted that too and getting used to that too. The Himalayan backdrops, the awesome spaciousness of that. I love that video. What Himalayan instant enlightenment or something. The backdrops, the morphing of the backdrops. It's like, wow, that is really cool. And this is getting a good run here because we have a lot of white background, so it's going over. Now the question is, will this upload? But I'll just put it in Longchenpa's hands, whether it uploads or not. So the Nirmanakaya of Longchenpa is just a guy. Then the Sambhogakaya is transcendent of the of that, really, is transcendent of our polarities that we have here. And it's just sublime. 360 degrees sublime. But we can always go back to just the guy, you see? That's very helpful. We don't get lost in devotion to you know, heart devotion to Sambhogakaya. We stay awake, wide awake in recognition and appreciation and experiencing of it and abiding in it. And it's beyond what we would say the heart. It's beyond that. It's 360 degrees. It's like everywhere abidance. It's not located like a heart abidance. It's everywhere abidance. I think Mayor Baba came for these call them, masts, or M-A-S-T-S or something. They'd gotten lost in the heart, too much devotion, and they were stuck. And he was working with them to free them from that. Not that heart devotion can't develop in not that it can't be a path and then to open up into 360 degree everywhere abidance. It can, absolutely it can, but apparently you can also get stuck in that, as you can get stuck on any path actually. But maybe Mayor Baba was trying to get unstuck himself, actually. And this was part of his work. Might have been stuck on universal structure. You can get stuck on that too. I know he said he was an avatar and all that. Now maybe he was. I just couldn't quite. I didn't quite see it because of his cosmology. He was so much into this cosmology, and I'm not really into cosmology. You know, that's so. You know, I'm not. I see that as you know, still the play of dream play of scripting and structuring reality. Where in reality, there's no structures. Jesus said, God is not the architect of universes. So. The idea that God is the architect of cosmological architect of all this, you know, that it just, you know, doesn't fly with me. Doesn't fly. But he was certainly, Mayor Baba certainly was a very grace, you know, filled presence, and was quite extraordinary presence, to say the least. And his work was a lot with these people who were stuck. And maybe, like I said, maybe that was part of his karma too. To get free of some subtle stuckness that he had. This is a possibility. Look, I sort of see it that way. That would make sense. Or maybe not. Maybe he was liberated, I don't know. But, you know, I don't put him into our Dharma King group, because our Dharma King group tends to be free of cosmology, or totally free of any cosmology. That's very important. They don't emphasize cosmology at all. Again, Jesus says God is not the architect of universes. That's part of our dream. Longchenpa does not emphasize cosmology at all. Ramana Maharshi never talked about cosmology. Sri Sri Anandamayi never talked about cosmology, really. No. She said all these realms, even the demigods and goddesses, this whole thing is all just a dream. It's all just a dream. It's all illusion. As Jamyang Kensi Choki Lodra also said, whatever comes and goes is not true at all. It's not true at all. It's an illusion. Well, the universe certainly comes and goes, doesn't it? It's just an illusion. So why bother with how an illusion is structured? That's a waste of time. So, you know, whether we get involved in cosmology or not, not right now, maybe later I'll be interested in cosmology, but I'm not right now. Definitely not. That's the answer to that. Of course, the Tibetan Joakul with theosophy was seemed to be obsessed with cosmology, astronomy, astrology, how the cosmos was this divine being where nothing can happen except for celestial alignments, and everything is all structured to happen, you know, based on dynamics, subtle dynamics. Guy, you know, he's very, very much into that. Theosophy is very much into that. And that's why I really couldn't go with that. I acknowledge his erudition just is extraordinary. But again, I just don't have any interest in cosmology at all. I mean, I look at the stars, I don't care. I don't care how many stars there are. Space doesn't interest me. The universal space, the space of the universe, has never interested me. As far as I'm concerned, that's just all an illusion. It has no real relevancy at all to reality. What, does quantity determine reality? So there's trillions of solar disks. Does that mean they're real? Just because of the number? Well, there's a lot of grains of sand on the beaches of the world, too. A lot of water particles. Does that mean that the matter exists? How does quantity... How is reality at the mercy of quantification? I dream, you know, a million imaginary grains of sand. Does that mean that they become real because there's a trillion and one? And if there was minus a trillion and one, then they're not real? Well, that's ludicrous. I don't care how many galaxies there are, how many planets there are, so what? But we've overcome reality with number of dream fragments, dream figures, a bunch of dream suns, so that makes them real. This is ridiculous. I put like a trillion labels to nothing. Does that make nothing something? I hope I'm losing weight today by not eating. It's like 1 o'clock. I haven't eaten anything. I'm doing my penance, you know. I don't eat. Penance. But it's slow work, penance, isn't it? Yeah, we've got to do better than penance, okay? That was kind of the Christian way, some way. That's not the right way. It's too slow. And we should have recognized that by now. We got caught. You know, the ETs caught up with us, didn't they? And if you don't think the ETs are not meddling in the affairs of this world, then I got a bridge to sell you, you know? They absolutely are meddling, heavily so. And have been for quite some time. They're very clever about it. They stay behind the scenes. They use us as patsies, so they can blame it all on us. They can blame the ill effects of their meddling upon us, just as the Illuminati, New World Order folks, cabal, set up patsies to blame the various troubles and catastrophes they bring about. They have someone to blame it on them, so no one suspects that they set it up. The ETs are the same way, except even more so. They're using the New World Order cabal as patsies, setting them up to take the fall. And, you know, when buyer's regret comes about. Oh yeah, it's the Illuminati's fault. They're the fault. Let's go get them. No, they're just patsies for the ETs, actually. And behind these ETs are other ETs, cosmic dream dynamics that are using them as patsies. You know, everybody's using others to avoid their own arrogance, recognizing their own futility of their own arrogance. This is how it actually works, how the universe really works. I mean, Joao Cools always say, gee, the hierarchy, we've had all these plans, but we had to change them all. What happened, DK? Well, we had it all figured out on our cosmic computers and all the dynamics. Then he says, but God loves mysteries. So somehow God threw a new dynamic in that we couldn't account for, and things didn't go the way we thought they would go. That's what you get with all these ascended masters being channeled. You know, say, what happened? Well, my children, you know, we're still with you, and we still pray for your well-being and everything. But, you know, the opposition, you know, did something we didn't expect, or was stronger than we thought, and we have to make adjustments for that. But ultimately, they blame it on God. God loves mysteries. That's the favorite one. God loves mysteries. No, God loves freedom. God loves freedom. And guess, oh, someone decided to exercise their freedom. Whoops, what happened to our cosmic dynamics? Whoops. Some Dharma king decided to pour out grace. Someone asked for the grace of the Dharma kings, and they poured out grace. Oh, our dynamics have gotten messed up. Our software couldn't account for that, huh? Okay, well, we're busy making adjustments. That's part of it. Got to be a good server. You got to really make adjustments here. And then we'll be right back. We'll have the answer soon. Don't worry. Just wait a little bit, and we'll have it. Well, guess what? There's always grace at work. Can you predict grace? Only the Holy Spirit can. Because the Holy Spirit's already saved everyone. All aspects of spirit have already been saved by the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit knows the end from the very beginning, actually. Otherwise, predicting grace is don't try to get into that business. Spiritual hierarchies running around and doing a fire drill, you know, like, like, now you're supposed to do this. I told you what. And you know, these guys who want to be controlling, they couldn't account for Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. That's why they left her out of it, left her out of their pantheon of great teachers, because they said, we got control, we can figure out how these other I can control, but they couldn't really control her, so they just ignored her. They just ignored her completely. It's pretty funny. Here's these teachers. Yeah, we're bringing to light, you know, all the great teachers of history, and showing you who they are and what they're about, and yeah, we're greater than all of them and all this stuff. Oh, but they left out Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. A convenient omission, huh? Yeah, convenient, because they couldn't quite account for her grace and how that works, and it's a wild card. It's a wild card. When knowing comes here, it's a wild card, isn't it? So the Dharma kings have the knowing. They have the knowing, and you cannot account for how the grace that they will bring. And so they... But it's always better. Things always work out better than the spiritual hierarchy expects. But they have to keep adjusting their plans to control it. The cosmology, I'm not sure how to control the cosmology. It shifted a little bit. We didn't realize it. We have to get more understanding of how the cosmology works, you know. More understanding about how pure freedom works. What is that? That's a fool's errand. There's no understanding about how freedom works. It's free. It's whatever we want is how it works. There's no cosmology to freedom. There's no cosmology to freedom. That's a dream. Cosmology is a dream. It's a big dream, you know, it's full of, wow, you know, like, complexity. It'll keep you busy with complexity if you want to for a long time, so you don't repent. And truly repent, you know, from all your, from arrogance. It'll keep you busy, for sure. They have an idea of how they want to structure, you know, the world. Theosophy. And Alice Bailey was a very high-hatted woman. say the least. So was Annie Besant. And they, you know, being women, they felt they knew what's best, how to structure society and culture, and they went about doing it. And they, the United Nations is their child, actually. The United Nations is the child of theosophy, actually. Child of Maitreya and Kuthumi and DK and the hierarchy and all this, and they feel that, that they know how to structure society going forward in a new world order. Now, there's, you know, there's some, certainly there are ways to structure society, culture that are more beneficial, so sure, they could be very helpful. However, you can go too far in that direction. You have to put your attention on the Dharma kings. This is what I found out. And you cannot account for their grace. So it's a over trying to make too much of an institutional structure gets in the way of salvation. Actually, in Carlos Castaneda, Don Juan, he said that whether you believe in Dhamma or not, the Yaqui way of knowledge, the tradition, he said actually having a despotic type of lousy governance and stuff is actually better because it calls upon your resources much better. You have to be very, very resourceful and determined. And this is what ultimately leads to liberation. Whereas you just have this nice bureaucracy of institutions and you know, schooling and everything, and it just is the way it is. You know, it's like you think you just go through the motions and you think, okay, that's good enough. So there's a real danger in that, actually. Nobody can be repent unless they want to. I don't care how you structure society. So you could have the spiritual materialism come in. You can't force acceptance of freedom on anyone because they're free to disregard it, you see? And the power of freedom is just as much present in the freedom to disregard freedom as it is in to regard freedom. So you cannot force the issue. And so they feel that they have a way of bringing it along. Well, maybe they do have a way of bringing it along, but that's not all there is to it. Okay, that's not all there is to it. And I've never heard any of our Dharma kings talk about some spiritual hierarchy of ascended masters, okay? I've never heard any talk about that. Never. Jesus never said anything about that. Sri Sri Anandamayi never said anything about it. Longchenpa's never said anything about it. And Ramana Maharshi has never said anything about it. That doesn't mean it doesn't exist, okay? They just have not put the emphasis on it, okay? Now, these ascended masters, quote-unquote, are very likely ETs, actually. In fact, they even said they are. They're lodged on Sirius. They say, yeah, we're headquartered in Sirius, and we have lodges all over place, and we are, you know, extraterrestrial beings, a lot of us, and we visit you here on Earth. And so, okay. Doesn't make them right. Doesn't make them wrong. Okay. But certainly it doesn't preclude those who are free of any such cosmology altogether. Is Vajrasattva an ET? No. Was Padmasattva ET? No. And if some try to say he was, well, either he was or he wasn't, but Vajrasattva is not an ET. The bliss body is not an ET. Okay. No, it's not. This is just the living light itself showing itself to us in a perceptual way associated with what we're familiar with. So it might have an outline of a human form, for instance. If it showed up to some ET, it might have the outline of how the ET form looks like or something. All right. But that's not the outline of a form. It's just for the standpoint of familiarity reference. What it really is the living light itself showing you its 360-degree pristine unbelievability, that you are that. Say, I am that. It's showing you this is what you are. at least perceptually, this is as far as you can go, but this is healed perception. What was that? That was a weird sound, was it not? Huh. Some birds or something. That really startled me. It sounded like there was something right here. Oh, there it is again. They could throw their voice. This is like a voice. On telepathy, for instance. ETs can do telepathy. Okay, well, B. That's very nice. That doesn't mean you're enlightened. That's just a way that they're used to communicating through telepathy. So they're used to using energy in all sorts of ways. So what? Energy is just a dream, actually. Oscillation energy, that's just a dream. That's not reality. Reality doesn't oscillate. Reality is instantaneous. Reality is right here, right now, always. It's just ornamentation, again, of its own spaciousness. Energy is just ornamentation of its own spaciousness. As Jesus calls it, it's like frozen light. Calls it like extremely, extremely, extremely frozen light, what we call energy, what we call the light of our sun. Jesus says it's a dream. It's early. We asked light, to freeze itself into not being light, not being responsive to us. So this is what he says, this world, the universe of energy that we see. He says that's not the true kingdom of heaven really at all. It's not separate from it, but it's not really the experiencing of it that God, you know, that we can have, where everything is just instantaneous, always instantaneous. So yeah, Jesus very explicitly said this universe is just our desire to have light not be light, be completely frozen, so we can get this impression of separation from God. So who cares about the cosmology of this universe? Well, I don't that much. Maybe at some point there's some reason to be interested in it or pay attention in some way. Oh, fine, that's fine. Maybe later. Yeah. From a pragmatic standpoint. You might call the universe the big dream, right? In this world here, a dream within the big dream, or part of the big dream. But it's all just one dream. Dreaming is dreaming. Don't get lost in anything else except dreaming is just dreaming. That's all it is. And awakening is simple as repenting and dropping the arrogance, and we don't have to dream anymore. We don't feel any need to dream anymore. That's all. We don't have to work anything out in the dream, actually. We don't have to work out any of the dream content. Doesn't have to be anything in particular to awaken from a dream. Now, it helps, Jesus said, to dream a happy dream, a blissful dream, to awaken from the dream, because that's similar to reality. We feel like it solves a continuity problem. But technically, we don't have to have, the content of the dream doesn't have to be any which way at all. That's why we can just leave everything just exactly the way it is. And see the bliss body nature of it all, which is just light, presenting all this. We don't have to change the world in any particular way, or do anything about it. Like Ramana said, just put on sandals. If you want to walk the world, don't try to clean the world of all stones, pebbles, thorns, stickers, etc. Just wear shoes, wear sandals. That's the quick way, isn't it? It's the only way, really, because the other way is never going to succeed. Very intense time, huh? But Jen, just keep digging in. Hold your ground, hold your ground, hold your ground. Are we losing ground here? No. No. Are we gaining ground? Yeah, we are. So we're holding our ground, we're not losing ground, and then we're making some progress here. Is that going to stop, you know, what's coming upon the world? No. Too many want it to happen to stop it. There's not enough repentance in the world to stop it. unlikely. Will it alter a little bit? It might. What we're doing here, it might alter a little bit. Might lessen the intensity of it as some are being attracted to the Dharma kings, attracted to the truth here, attracted to this. That does have some effect on altering the intensity of it, for sure. Lessening it, yeah. But not entirely precluding it, no. Because again, we're absolutely free to deny freedom if we want to. That's part of our freedom. So it's all powerful. I mean, you can't just find some dynamic to stop that. It's impossible. You have to repent. It's the only way. As Jesus said, nobody enters the kingdom of heaven except through first repenting. This is absolutely true. Absolutely true. Doesn't matter how you manipulate energy, that will never get you in the kingdom of heaven. Unless you repent, you cannot get in. Because you have to drop your arrogance, right? And you have to recognize all this has just been a dance of your own freedom. Nothing other than that. Nothing ever happened, in other words, to me. Nothing ever happened. Now, it's a testimony to the determination of those who have realized this, not to their cleverness, but to their determination. Because there's nothing they needed to do. If nothing ever happened, what do they need to do? Nothing. They have to realize it. And we're having troubles realizing it. Well, those who did realize it, they did through the great determination. They refused to be sidetracked from it. They said, "No, I don't need to do anything. I know nothing ever happened, so I have a right to see that. I can see it. It's there to be seen. It's there to be seen." So we honor their greatness, really. We really do. We very much appreciate it. It's a very nice feeling to fast, isn't it? Fasting is really good. It feels good. Maybe there's some pain inhibitors that are released in the brain or something. Like, oh, I don't have any food. I'm going to starve. I better, you know, kill the pain of it. I don't know. Maybe there's something to do it like that. How are your workouts doing? How's everyone's workouts doing? Whether, you know, nutritional goals, exercise goals, those little goals, but they help keep you grounded, right? So I can't go off and get lazy because I still have these goals. I got to reach these goals. I was close. I almost got a good number on the scale this morning, and then I tried again, and it went up higher. I said, "What? I like the first reading." I tried to get a lower one, I got a higher one. So don't get greedy. I said, I should have taken the lower ones. That's good enough. So I'm pulling myself back towards, you know, trying to optimal weight. And wow, is it difficult. What a battle. As far as exercise, I'm taking it easy. I'm letting my body recover. My body's very exhausted from all everything I've been doing. I've got to let it heal up. But what I found is just doing functional exercises. This is what I've been avoiding. You know, the guys in the gym pumping so much iron, doing functional exercises, they may not be able to do that very well. Like just like squatting down. Do squats. Just squat down and then go back. Then stand up, keeping your back straight and balanced. So I can like squat down totally on my heels, completely squatted, and then go right straight back up quickly without losing my balance in any way. So I started doing reps of those, like 5 at first, and then I'm doing 10 now. Wow. it really gets you after a while. But that's called functional exercises. Functional. How do you get up from the ground? This is how you know how good a shape you are. If you're on the ground in some position, do you have to like grab something and pull yourself up? Or can you just like spring? Like, remember when you're young, you just sort of spring up like a cat. You just, like, how do you do that? Well, that means you're in really good shape. If you can just spring up onto your feet from whatever position you're in, just spring to your feet. That is called functional exercise. And this is what I'm trying to get into now. Not so much of like, you know, upper body strength and stuff. That was causing problems with my neck anyway. But tightening up too much in the shoulders pulls the neck out of alignment. But functional, try functional exercises. Just lie on your side, and then how do you get up from that position? Try getting up from an awkward position. Try recovering from an awkward position. This is really, really good training. Put yourself in an awkward position, then see how you can recover from it, then practice that. This will really give you confidence in your life. Really give you confidence. Sort of a basic confidence, but it'll help. And I'm not so good at it right now. I really have to work at this. This is on my mind. I'm starting to get into this now. This is what I want to start doing. It's embarrassing because you feel clumsy. I can't get up. Just think about old people. They can't get up. They're terrified of falling. They can't get up. Well, we better start practicing being on the ground and getting up, springing up. I'm also jumping up this wall that I have. I said, I got to practice leaping up on this, but I couldn't do it. I was intimidated. I thought I can't do it. Finally, yesterday or day before, I started trying it in a lower area, and I was able to jump up and then jump down, jump up, jump down. I use a little stick to make sure that I don't fall or fail, because it's a little crutch kind of thing. That was helpful. I decided, let me try that. I use a golf club as a crutch, and I jump up and jump down. And then I started jumping around. I finally jumped up on the highest area of the wall where it's most difficult. And I was able to do that. I was just like, wow, I can do it. It's like, holy cow, that's been one of my goals. I can do this. And this really gives you confidence. The ability to jump up on something will give you great confidence, actually. Because when you're young, couldn't you leap? Couldn't you jump and leap? Didn't the young people love jumping and leaping? Absolutely, springy, very springy. They're very springy, so they enjoy being springy. They say up curve, they jump up on this. Maybe I see something. Let me see if I can leap up on this. That is fun. You know, the parkour guys, just leaping and vaulting and jumping. It's like, that's fun. That's springy. It's very confident you can just suddenly spring up on something, like a cat. So be like a cat, very springy. When you lose that springiness, you start to get worried and frightened, don't you? So I'm trying to get some of that springiness, but I'm not so springy. I keep doing jump rope, but you got to practice it in situations. Put yourself in purpose on the floor, on your stomach. How fast can you get up from your stomach? On your side, how fast can you get up from your side? On your back, how fast can you get up? On your knees, how fast can you spring up? When you're squatting down, how fast can you get up like this? And keep your balance, just instant balance, just like that. On one arm, like you're propped on one arm, leaning on an arm, how quickly can you get up? Like that, or how quick can you jump up on something? Try your springiness, recoverability, springiness and recoverability. Because that will be needed going forward. Of course, they're going to try to knock us out here in the world. Knock us to our feet. Knock us off our feet. Well, we'll just spring right back up, won't we? How quickly can you get back on your feet and be knocked down? Someone shoves you down. You shove down. How quickly can you just pop back up, fresh as a daisy? Don't get all, oh, what happened? Which is why trail running, oh, hummingbirds here right in front of me, hello, nice, is helpful, because you're hit with all these rocks and potholes and got to keep your balance. It's not just walking along on a street. That doesn't really give you recoverability. Whereas trail running, you're always thrown off balance. You're always being thrown off balance. So being practiced, being thrown off balance is very helpful. It's very helpful. And then recovering, keeping your balance if you're being thrown off balance. Very, very helpful. So I'm trying to get into more of that. And it puts a strain on your body. It really does, because you're not used to it. You know, this guy, people just jog. I jog 2 miles. They were just going along, asphalt thing, road, just straight. Never off balance at all. Never challenged in any way. Try to get them to, be springy off balance, and they can't do it. Or if you just lift weights, you can't do it. It doesn't really give you that sort of strength. But you just try to run on a very uneven trail. Wow, I've been doing that a little bit. Just potholes everywhere. You just have to kind of run side to side and zigzag around all these obstacles. That will really, you feel it in your body. Just, oh, what an ordeal. And yet kids, they do that naturally, don't they? Do you see kids running in straight lines too much? Don't they love zigzagging and going all over the place, and right? And falling down and jumping up and stuff. They just love it. Yeah, I always used to hate running track because it's just got to run a straight line. What is that? Kids like running around obstacles and through doors and through rooms and stuff. They love that, don't they? They don't love running just straight. Because their minds are open and flexible, right? Freedom. They have this sort of flexible freedomness, like anything's possible. I can run over here, there, 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 there. I can go there fast. So they like, it's a game for them. They love doing that just as a game. They want to find a windy street. Let me find a windy path. Oh, I love these, like that, being windy and this things. And like, mountain biking sort of like that way too, right? All these obstacles that really challenge you in all different directions. Dirt biking, various things like that. But just going on a track, plodding along on a track, oof. That's a rough one. And so, doing a lot of exercise, you may not realize, you may not reach your goals because you still don't feel the springability. And this is when you have to do actual calisthenics of various types. And I still haven't gotten down to doing that as much as I should. Need to do that. That's the next step. The body's saying, no, it's torture. Well, it's better to be tortured now than tortured later, right? Better be in charge of your own torture, to get in good shape so that others don't get in charge of your torture. That is for sure. How are we doing here? Springing right along. You know how it is, like, you get older, like getting up, you don't just spring up. It's difficult. Like, I put your hands on something and kind of push yourself up, right? I feel like I got to push myself up right now because I'm tired. I've been through a severe ordeal the last 3 weeks. I just don't have the nerve to. But this is what you need. Just not push yourself up. Just spring up. Spring out of your seat. Can you just have a seat and just spring out of it? Maybe you should have like a chair practicing and just like put a chair outside somewhere in your room and just like spring out of your chair. No pushing with your arms or shoulders. Just spring out of your chair. Boom. Like that. Your feet are down. You're pushing. You're out of your chair like that. How long does it take the kid to get out of their chair? Don't they just like leap out of it? Do they go, let me see if I can slide out of this chair. Grab a hold of this and pull yourself up. That's what old people do, of course. Kids, they leap out of their chair. They spring out of it. They shoot out of their chair. Oh, we got something to do. Oh, we're gone. We're going somewhere. Okay, let's go. They're on their feet like that. Their feet are under them. So that's really important to get your feet under you and use your feet and use your legs like that instead of the upper body just, let me push it. And use the feet. And start doing it. Be creative. Don't just go to the weight room, go to the gym and hit, you know, hit the treadmill or hit the weights. I mean, that is not sufficient. It's not sufficient. You need real life flexibility and spring ability, recoverability. Are you springy? Are you bouncy? Can you bounce back from this and that? Yeah. Off balance. Can you catch your balance? Can you recover your balance? You know, put yourself in an out of balance situation, then try to recover. Practice recovering it. This is real training. You know, and of course, good trainers will do this. Good trainers know this. It's not about, hey, let's go to the gym and hit the weights. That's not a good trainer. Good trainers know how to put you through this real life, you know, recovering your balance situations and springiness and all that sort of stuff. So they're always having different practices to help you with that. Those are the real good trainers. Those are the ones you want. Maybe they'll just like get behind you and like push you off balance suddenly. And you have to practice, you know, recovering from that. And you don't know how they're going to push you. And so you cannot be committed to any particular path, right? When there's someone behind you who's going to push you, you don't know where they're going to push you. Are they going to pull you or something? You don't know. So the best way is just to be relaxed, 360 degree pristine, unbelievable ability. And whatever happens, then you just recover from that. But if you think, okay, I think they're going to push me there, you're already committed to trying to deal with that, and they push you another direction, you tumble. This is really the secret of martial arts. Martial arts are actually a corollary to this, can be a corollary to the spiritual path, a physicality to practice this. You know, you hear that, you know, the Zen master is a martial arts master, the Aikido master would. And they never commit. They always stay uncommitted, completely uncommitted in the moment, in the now. And so they just go with the flow of whatever's happening and never getting attached to anything at all. Where, so the others, they can see that they commit. And so they just, the masters, they just wait for the commitment. And then, whew, they're not there. You see, they because they're not committed. Their mind's open, completely open and free. It's free. That's the secret to martial arts, really. And if you have two masters, what do? They'll just both stand there. And then at some point, they'll just bow to one another, and that's it. Because neither one is committing at all. And the whole point of this is to train to this non-commitment. This freedom, this openness, 360 degree pristine unbelievability. So, I think martial arts developed like in China or something. There was a strong corollary. It happened in monasteries where people are practicing Buddhism. It's a way to use our physicality in a way that helps our spiritual path. Also, it was eventually used to protect the monks from all sorts of troubles, but ultimately it's not designed. It's designed for this. Stay in the now. Stay right here in the moment. Free in the moment. All possibilities are there, and I'm open to all possibilities. So here's a possibility. Okay, then I'll just deal with that possibility. But I remain open to all possibilities while dealing with this possibility as well. So these great Aikido masters, you know, no matter what comes at them, they're never out of balance. They never get thrown, you know, for a loss, and they just seem always poised. And just step this way, this way, this way, this okay, and they're still uncommitted to what's the next step. Well, it could be anything at all. They're relaxed. They're peaceful. Now, you know, in that the Kung Fu TV series, it was the master said, you have to snatch the pebble out of my hand in order to get it. You know, then you're a master if you can get the pebble from me. Or something like that. Well, the answer is very simple. And as you just, you tell, you know, the master, you realize the pebble's already in your hand. It's already there. As long as you're trying to snatch it, you don't get it. Because you never get it, right? The master always frustrates you. And then you realize you don't have to get it. It's already there. So Cain went about looking, you know, for this wisdom knowledge, martial arts knowledge. How do I get that pebble from the master's hand? I gotta figure it out. What do you mean? You already have it. It's already in your hand. It's always been there. The master never took it away from you. It's just an illusion. The master's just frustrating your illusion, pointing out to you the illusion you think someone else has yourself. Then the master said, well, you gotta get yourself back, and it keeps frustrating you until you realize, wait, that's all just an illusion. I never lost the pebble. I'd always had it. I don't have to. It's already there. I never lost it. Just an illusion. The master has my pebble. No, it's just an illusion. Just a dream. I never lost myself. I never lost my freedom. In fact, I've been exercising it all along. So what continuity problem is there really? I never stopped exercising my freedom. I just use my freedom to try and deny myself, to, you know, bind my freedom, to deny myself freedom. But that's still exercising my freedom. So I never stopped. So there's no continuity gap at all, actually. There's no continuity gap at all. See, our continuity fear is based on not seeing properly, that, right? So it's not solved by leaping over a gap. There's no gap there actually at all. It comes from realizing there is no gap, recognizing there is no gap. So there isn't really actually a continuity problem, but we fear that there is a continuity problem. Okay, this is the trouble. And our fear only subsides not by solving the continuity gap, but by recognizing there is no continuity gap. We don't snatch the pebble away. It realizes, it's all, I already have it. I'm just imagining it somewhere else. And you know, when you see it, you say, oh, how did I get that? No, you realize that I always had it. I was just hallucinating that I didn't. So, and I was using my freedom to hallucinate. Well, I was still using my freedom, so I didn't stop being free. We never have stopped being free, and we have never stopped exercising our freedom. So there isn't any actual continuity gap at all. There isn't any actual continuity gap at all. And that in itself is a wow, isn't it? Wow. It's changed the landscape. See, the landscape I said earlier, we go into this practice, we will come out of it fundamentally different, irretrievably changed as far as our perspective is concerned. We'll never be the same again. And this is so, is it not? But we don't think about it. Just wow it. Just wow it. Don't think about it. Don't measure how much we've changed. Don't measure it. No need to do any measuring. It's there anyway. We never never stopped. We've never stopped exercising our freedom. 100%. 100%. So there's no actual continuity gap at all. None. But in our arrogance, when we recognize our freedom, we'll say, wait a minute, you know, when's the continuity gap going to hit me? This is, you know, believing that our arrogance somehow stopped freedom. It didn't stop freedom. There's no continuity gap. So it's not going to come up and bite you. The more we recognize this, the easier it is going to be for our to abide, because we're not looking over our shoulder and say, well, okay, I've been abiding for a little while, but when's the trouble going to hit me? There's no trouble that's going to hit us. There's no gap. We never stopped being what we are. Even though we've hallucinated that we stopped. But a hallucination of stopping isn't stopping. Let's say you're driving down the road and you start hallucinating that you've stopped at a gas station. Well, then you stop hallucinating and you're driving down the road and say, whoa. You say, whoa. Huh, how did I take off from that? How did I get out of that gas station? Yeah, that's weird. No, you never stopped. So if we're hallucinating that we're stopped at a gas station and we're still driving down the road, did we actually stop? No, we didn't stop. And you might say, well, how am I so far along to my destination? I stopped at a gas station for a while. I must have really speeded up. I just wasn't aware of how fast I had speeded up. No, we were just going the same rate of speed. We just never stopped at the gas station. So you see how hallucination plays tricks with our mind, doesn't it not? Again, let's say we're going to Yosemite and driving Yosemite. It's like a four-hour drive, and we're going along, and we get kind of drowsy, and we're still going, you know, whatever speed, and steady speed, get there in 4 hours. We start daydreaming that we've stopped at a gas station, and we're having lunch there at the gas station, and we stop for like an hour or so, and then. We get back in the car and we're driving, and then we wake up from the hallucination. We say, oh, huh, I must have dozed off or something. Okay. And then you say, okay, well, still at least must be, you know, a couple hours out. And you start looking. You say, wait a minute. This road here, I'm noticing this. We're almost there. I say, how's that possible? What happened? So what? And then you start thinking, wow, I must have been traveling a lot faster than I realized, because we stopped for an hour and a half for lunch and gas. We shouldn't be this far along. And you start getting worried. Say, what's going on here? Maybe I've been speeding. Uh-oh. I've been going a lot faster than I realized, huh? And then you start rationalizing, you know, making up excuses to avoid realizing that you've been hallucinating. But the fact is, you never stop for lunch or for gas. You've been going the same speed the whole time. That's the answer. But we never think about that as the answer, do we? We're always trying to come up with some other answer that excuses our hallucinating. Say, no, we didn't hallucinate. So we have to come up with some answer that accounts for our stopping. And so then you tie yourself in knots, all sorts of weird explanations. Say, well, I was really speeding, but that's dangerous. You know, I shouldn't be doing that. What's wrong with me? Maybe I shouldn't be going here. If I speed up like that, maybe it's a danger. I shouldn't be taking this trip in the first place, you know. And before you know, you're all tangled up in all sorts of worries and concerns and thoughts and weirdness and stuff. The simple answer is you never stopped. See how easy that is? Poof! All our ruminations gone. We don't need them. All our thinking gone. We don't need it. The mind is relaxed. Like, oh, okay. Maybe I shouldn't get so drowsy. Right? How long did the dream take? Maybe it only took an instant. But if you dream that you stop for an hour and a half, and then you wake up, you'll feel you're an hour and a half further along down the road than you should be, won't you? And the whole dream may have just taken an instant. You may have just dozed off just for an instant. But when you wake up, nothing seems right. Because you say, wait a minute, I'm an hour and a half further along than I should be. You see how that works? So you didn't daydream for an hour and a half, necessarily. You may have just daydreamed for an instant. But then nothing jives when you wake up. It doesn't jive with your daydream. You should be way back down the road, an hour and a half back from where you are. And then you start, wow, weird, weird, weird. This is really weird. So our mind plays tricks on us, like that we play tricks on ourselves because of arrogance and the hallucination and pretense and all of that. It just really keeps us thinking about a situation that doesn't actually even exist. I shouldn't be here. What's wrong? It's odd. Yeah. I shouldn't be this far along, advanced. You know, when's the continuity gap going to hit me? I know I stopped my freedom. I know I've been in prison for a long time. No, actually, our whole dream is moment by moment. So it's just in just an instant. We're actually dreaming of billions of years of time each instant. So there's no continuity, and we're free. We're exercising our freedom and doing this. There's no continuity gap at all. None. But we're thinking, well, there's billions of years. What do you mean? We stopped our freedom for billions of years. No, we haven't. I remember I had this experience where I was daydreaming and just went and just sort of slipped into a dream. And I dreamed of millions of years. And then I woke up and I said, wow, how long have I been dreaming? How long have I been asleep? And then I became aware that I just dozed off just for an instant. Somehow I realized it was just the same time. I said, how's that possible? I just experienced millions of years. Our imagining capability can imagine time, can imagine as much time as we want, just this instant. It can imagine a billion years. And all this stuff that happened in a billion years, it all in just an instant. And this is exercising our freedom of creativity. So there isn't any real continuity gap at all. We've never stopped exercising our freedom, not even for an instant. Not even for an instant have we stopped. So we don't have to start it up again. There isn't something we have to do to start it up again. It never stopped. And there's nothing going to hit us, something unexpected going to hit us at all in abidance. There's nothing, no gap, no ripple, no disturbance to hit us at all. What happens is we think it's delayed. Uh-oh, a delayed reaction's coming. I better get out of abidance. I better avoid it because I'm going to get hit. There's no delayed reaction happening, actually. There are no ripples, no distortions, no currents, nothing at all in reality. Reality is just still and peaceful as it's always been because nothing's ever happened to it. Our freedom, we've been exercising it all along. It never stopped. We don't need to start it up. We never distorted it. It doesn't need to be straightened out. It's still perfect. Can I get a hallelujah? Can we get a hallelujah? Yes. So here's another technical point about abidance. It's very important. We never lost our freedom. So it doesn't need to be found at all. So when we're in abidance, we say, well, how did I find it? We don't need to say how I find it. We never lost it. We didn't find it. We never stopped being free. So the issue of, well, if I don't know how I found it, what if I lose it again? How will I find it? That's a non-issue. See, that's a fake non-issue that takes us out of abidance. We start thinking, okay, well, how did I find it? We didn't find it. We realized there's nothing to find because we never stopped. If we never stopped, how could we say that we found it? Finding it implies we've been somewhere where it wasn't. We've never been anywhere where it wasn't. We've never been in time at all. Nice day now, 1 o'clock. Feels very balmy, very beautiful. Beautiful clouds, beautiful spring. The spring's been beautiful. Supposed to heat up this week. Some say 93, 98, I don't know. Supposed to jump into the 90s for one day and then back come the clouds for 5 days or more. It's kind of like that. It's very beautiful. It warms up and then the clouds come back and it's very beautiful, like 72, 73, you know, just mid-70s with beautiful white floaty cumulus clouds floating. like a dreamland, and then it'll like heat up, high pressure heat, it'll heat up for a couple days, and then the clouds come back, same thing. It's like, wow, yeah, how can you beat that? I mean, the weather in California the last 5 years has been like a dream. It really has. It's just like every day is just wonderful. Now maybe that's a reflection of my progress on the path, I don't know. But for me, that's how I've been experiencing it. It's just like every day you just want to bottle it and drink it. You know, just put it in the fridge and for later consumption. It's so gorgeous here. Wow. Just a benign breeze, you know, just enough to tickle everything and alternate just soft warmth and soft coolness, just alternating. But here we are, slaving away, right?